What we're going to be proposing today is a stormwater quality pond that's located primarily on an open space parcel. I believe Dale had sent out an email to everybody, kind of filling them in on a couple of the issues, and I can touch on a couple of the bullet points from that quickly. The parcel was dedicated to the county by the Stein family in the late 70s as part of approvals for the AABC storage units. It was adopted as the Stein Riverside Park by Open Space about 10 years ago. This property wasn't actually purchased with the Open Space restricted funds, therefore it's not subject to the conversion limits of the charter, but they'd still want to see it used in that spirit. And so that's a conversation that's happening right now. We did get some direction to keep moving forward with that design from the Open Space Board, but we thought that the joint session that you guys have, I believe it's the 25th, would be a good opportunity to touch on that subject. Other coordination that we've had is we did have another AABC stakeholder meeting yesterday with some of the business owners out in AABC that John McBride and some of his staff put together. So we had a good meeting with them. We talked about all the a lot of the different planning processes that we have going out on around their neighborhood, and we did touch on a lot of that. So with all that being said, let's jump into that stormwater system. This first graphic that we have shows a little variation to what we talked about this past spring. We won't go through the entirety of the AABC, but to give a little bit of context, this is the 400 road here. That's one of the back roads. This is a lot of the housing back here. And this
condominiums,
is,
right?
Condominiums, yeah. And this is the Stein Trail right here. Roaring Fork River is down on the right. Aspen Consolidated Sanitation District is up in this upper right-hand corner. What staff had been proposing is with the water collection system that's in the AABC, currently about 80% of that flows down this Stein Trail. The rest of it wasn't really collected and put too many places. There's some dry wells that tried to handle some of that. Wasn't all that successful in some areas, more successful in others. But collect water from the 200 road down here and bring it down from the Baltic Avenue, 300, 400, and 100 roads would come down here. What we're going to be looking at here is a proposed stormwater quality pond here, and then the piping of, out from that down towards the river. So that's going to be a big part of our focus for what we talk about here.
Jack, can I ask a question?
Go ahead, Rachel.
It was mentioned in the memo that the land was originally given for Stein Park from the self-storage units.
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of lower dotted line coming in from that side of the drainage? I mean, I'm kind of wondering where the self-storage units
are. Self-storage units are out
front side.
They're actually off of the 200 road. They're out of view on this map.
Okay. But
I don't know.
I guess I'm thinking of the storage units that are closer to the river near the electric transformer station.
And that's back on that 200 road.
Okay, so that does absorb the drainage from that side of the business center as well?
Yes.
Okay.
And that's what this configuration here is, collecting that side of the business center and bringing it all in together.
Thank you.
So there's a number of different things that we looked at. Water retention ponds that would be located along the Stein Trail. A thing that's called a downstream defender. It's a vortex separator which removes oil, fine sediment, trash, debris, things like that, and using sump inlets for the encatchment. We'll go over what the details of each of those are. There's a lot of different methods to collect stormwater and treat it. These are the tools that we thought would best fit in the AABC. We can use one, two, a combination of all three. I think that really what we're recommending is to try to get the water retention pond installed. Also use the sump inlets, and then we can always use the downstream defender as a backup plan if we're not able to get that pond onto that parcel.
Is there anything
Yeah, I'm just not clear. I mean, I would be under the impression we would use the downstream Defender and the pond.
Well, we can get into those details here when we go through each of them. And so we'll step through the water retention pond right now. We'll touch on the features of this almost mechanical separator, and then also the sump inlets. The water retention pond that's being designed would be able to treat a 100-year storm flow. It's actually really significant. It holds 1.36 acre feet of water. That might be a little bit Greek to some people, so to put that into context, an acre foot is if you have an acre of land with 1 foot of water on top of it. That's an acre foot. 1.36 acre feet would be like a 245-foot box with 1 foot of water in it. That's a significant amount of water that it can hold. Also, it has a controlled outlet. And so it's not, you know, if we have 100 CFS going in, we don't necessarily have 100 CFS pouring out. It's designed to dissipate that flow and have it go out over a longer period of time. Again, this is that same map with an aerial added into it. And you can see the footprint here of the pond that we're discussing. It does go into Holy Cross property, and we have started discussions with them over what types of easements and things like that we need to be able to construct that. For those of that have been back here, between the Roaring Fork River on the right and up here, there's probably 150 feet of elevation change. It's a really steep hillside. It has a pretty dry area, a lot of sagebrush, some scrubby plants. And so also, to be able to construct something like this, we'd have to look at reconstructing a bit of the trail, which the open space staff was excited about, because this area's needed a ton of maintenance over the last several years. It gets washed out probably an average of once a year.
So would the new design have the water piped?
Yes.
And then the trail on top of it, or roughly on top of it?
Yeah, existing right now, there is a vastly undersized pipe, and because of that, that actually causes a lot of the problems that we have there now. That pipe isn't able to handle that flow, backs up, spills over, and starts saturating that hillside above the consolidated sanitation district's plant there.
And GR, the outlet in the steep part is also, I mean, Rachel's talking about the flat, but...
Yeah, no, I'm talking about the...
is also pipe.
Yes.
Yeah. And what comes out is always meets a certain standard for water quality.
Yes.
And that's the intent, of course.
Yeah.
So
and Mike can,
get into that.
Yeah, Mike can touch on that right now, actually.
Yeah. The basis of what we use here, going back to the direction we were given, was try to put some kind of feature in there so we can treat the water before it discharges into the Roaring Fork River. As we've shown before, you know, you have the major collection in this point here, which is a high flow volume because it has a majority of the ABC site coming through here. Then off the 200 row, there's still a substantial amount, but probably half the flows or less than what we're experiencing on the other connections. So with our original proposal was to collect it in inlets through as it's coming down into those collection points and then piping it all the way down so we could protect the hillsides that's been eroding away. So initially it was into pipes, they came into a junction, and then it had one discharge point down to the river. So we stayed with the same concept, and what we did was there's a bowl area down where we've shown this feature here that we could utilize the existing bowl by building up some areas and creating a pond. And so when we went to sizing the pond, we took the approach using Denver's urban draining standards for water quality, which is the standards most of Colorado's using now for water quality within subdivisions and other area commercial areas. And the basis of that is it's capturing of a certain amount of flow. This is a minor storm in a five-year event that we've captured, so that's your regular type of flows you're getting through there. And it has a release period over 40 hours. So you take that volume coming down there, you capture it, you release it over a 40-hour period, and then allows you to settle out a lot of the total suspended solids. And with this typical design or the standards that we're following, you can get anywhere from an 80 to 90% TSS removal through that process on there. So that is your capture volume, and that gets rid of that first wash type stuff that we have a lot of problems with and where you really get the high concentrations in. The thing to remember with what we have in a basic design here is that we're not in a wet area. We're not down on the river, so we don't have access to groundwater. We don't have a constant stream coming down through there. So we got to, if we want to go something beyond just capturing water quality and getting the total suspended solids out, we have to look for something different. If we want to try to get some biological treatment. Now, you get a lot of removal with the total suspended solids. You have a lot of minerals and stuff attached with that, so you do get some sediment, but you're going to get some discharge from bacteria and other type of nutrients. And so to try to go to another level of treatment, your options are looking at trying to induce some biological type treatment, which is vegetation, and trying to get some contact time in there. So one of the things that we can look at here of going beyond your standard water capture, water quality capture pond, is to try to introduce something that can grow through intermittent streams, intermittent water that we're going to get, because it's basically off of storm water will be our water source coming through here, so our rainfall events. And there's plants that you can get and you can plant that only rely on certain times of the year having so much water, which is our springtime when you try to promote that growth. Here you're going to have your dry periods, but then you're going to get to monsoon, so you'll get some more water going down through there. So there's a good chance we can introduce trying to add a biological component to enhance this. It changes the character a little bit because we're on a dry sage hill, and that's something I think people need to reflect. That's really what we want to introduce here, but it is another level of treatment that you can gain from that. So this is easily fits within this area. We're on the open space parcel. We're on the Holy Cross parcel. So if we work through those as far as getting access to it, this is a good location for it. Now, something that we're concerned about from a maintenance perspective is trying to get all the big sands and gravels and stuff from wintertime. We don't want those washing down into the slower area, which is a little bit out of reach from your regular maintenance. So that's where we talked about adding all the inlets throughout the development or throughout the AEBC that we're going to be adding with the new storm sewer systems. We would add sump inlets, and I think we have a couple. That there. So basically what a sump inlet is that you have flows that come through and you have a bottom that's deeper. Most inlets just have a flat bottom, so what comes in goes right through it. It's just a collection and a conveyance. But with a sump, you can add a sump in here, so when you have water come through, you can get large particles and stuff to drop out, and then it'll fill up and then continue flowing through. That helps, and it always catches some of that bigger stuff. And what's nice about these features, it's right there on the roadway, so your maintenance vehicles can pull right up, and these are typically serviced by a vacuum, which you already have that equipment in place. And so you can go in there and you can pop them out. A lot of times depends on how much gravel or the sand you're putting down. You may have to do it on a yearly basis, maybe just every couple of years we have to go in there and remove what's been collected there. The more you remove, the better treatment you get, because they don't tend to wash through. So that's one thing that we think we would just add anyways, because it's easy to put in with the construction and the cost really isn't any higher with what we've already proposed. Another thing to do is what we've been talking about with that downstream defender, which this is a feature that is designed to supplement or actually sometimes even replace a water quality pond. It's a mechanical feature that they estimated with the types of flows. These are designed on the flows that you're dealing with, because they have different sizes. What we envisioned is we would try to put this in a location where we have our highest concentration of flows, which is in this area before we drop off the hillside. That's something, a mechanical feature you can add that's based on the flows that we're talking about, that could actually capture up to 80% of the total suspended solids before it even gets down into the pond, so you just get some additional treatment on there. Like I said, a lot of times people use those and replace the water quality ponds because of their effectiveness with that. That's capturing with lower volumes. It helps. It has a high cost associated with that, so that's something we have to weigh of are we really gaining enough, or does this feature that we're putting down below with the water quality pond, does that help us try to meet our goals with what we're trying to accomplish and save the money for that, for the downstream defender type. Another thing to consider up above, try to help capture some of the larger particles that get past the sump inlets, is other options is putting sand filter type small ponds. We don't have a lot of room in that area, so we can't put a large pond that can capture big volumes. It can capture lower volumes, and it can settle some stuff out. It'll be easy to maintain because it's right there off the roadway and very accessible, and the maintenance is not quite as difficult. That helps. It helps keep some of this stuff from going down the storm sewer and getting into the larger pond, and it really reduces the maintenance down the lower area. So those are things to think about. What level of treatment do we want to get with that, with what we're trying to propose out here? When we're right on the river, nutrients, bacteria, all those things are of concerns, as well as the total suspended solids on there.
So the whole system is what I'm assuming GR refers to as storm scepter, meaning the whole combination of elements?
Yeah, at the time that I wrote the memo too, we were looking at several different names. There's a lot of different brand names. That was one brand name. We decided for this to go with a different one, but this storm scepter is something that's very similar to the downstream defender. It's just a little bit different of a technology. So
it's a mechanical feature or system that would just be individual to itself.
Okay, well, when we get to the end of your presentation, both of you all, you need to identify exactly questions that you want answered or direction you need for the board. Doris, I see your hand.
Yeah, just a question. If you're almost done with the water retention pond issue, I know at the AAMC, I see a representative behind you, have concerns about the ongoing drainage issue at the 210 building. Mm-hmm. So as you're doing all this work in developing these systems, how do you address some of the drainage issues that some of the existing buildings are facing?
Well, specifics for places like the 210 building, and then also where Aspen Sprouts is, and a lot of those. Unfortunately, when the AAMC was built, a lot of these buildings were built low spots. They're dug out so that you get more height of the building. And so they have a lot of different drainage problems associated with that type of construction. With all of the stormwater system that we're proposing, a lot of this is now curbed. And so a lot of these buildings will be protected by a curb and gutter system. That will help channelize all of these flows. Specifically around the 210 building, we have a system of curb that'll go around that 90-degree curve that's right at that building. One of the problems that we have there is just before you get to that curb, that's the low spot. You actually have to go back up the hill to go around the curb, and we'd like to change the grade of the road there, and so we can get the water to move past the building and go into the encatchment that will catch all of that water from the 200 road. So basically what we're going to be doing is just channelizing that flow right past the building.
Thank you. You know, on this one item, I would have additional questions, which I think others would have as well. But I think that we should look to see how would this solution match up with the recommendations of the Roaring Fork Watershed Plan, you know, as to what standard we are reaching and are able to reach with our discharge. I think this is really very important. I mean, people always talk TDS, total dissolved solids, but that relates very much to whether we are able to maintain a gold medal fishery going forward and algae blooms and everything like that. I would be interested in seeing what sort of biological treatment elements we are able to plant within the pond, knowing that it's not a full-time water source and it doesn't have a full-time water source. But I think that can both add aesthetically to the look of the pond as well as improve its function. It's going to be really important for me to answer the questions about access for maintenance, because no matter what, you're eventually going to muck out the pond to keep it functioning. And so, you know, access and how do we get in there to do that is very important. I'm sure that there would be greater community questions about will this become an area for mosquito growth? Do we need to do larvae control in it? You know, what are the overall ongoing maintenance? And then, of course, you know, sometimes you get the impression of a marsh. You think of parts of New Jersey or something, and does it have a marshy odor? Is it going to be an odor generator? So those are the types of things I would be interested in. But, you know, in particular, I want to make sure that we don't underestimate the volumes at times when we're seeing these large, quick spring runoff melts, or the type of torrential rains that seem to be occurring more frequently that have flooded the airport level and things like that. So I think there's times when we're going to see some really high volumes. And, you know, I could have missed it, but I don't have, you know, kind of an overall spreadsheet of the different cost elements. And so it might be valuable to have that so we can look at, you know, what does it cost in total package? What would it cost if you phased and put this separator in later?
Okay.
Things like that. I mean, for me, water quality is an incredibly important component, and, you know, for whatever reasons, things weren't done in the past. They weren't as well known as what the issues could be. But, you know, if we're following the lead at any level, the city has done with its stormwater drainage runoff, that's huge. I mean, and it's really just important. You eventually will be forced to do these sort of things by the EPA for non-point source pollutions, and it's better to be ahead of that game than behind it, in my mind, for a whole variety of reasons. So those are the questions that I would really have going forward. I absolutely like the idea of the sump inlets, but we should have some sense of what the ongoing cost to our Public Works Department will be for that.
Okay, I can actually answer a number of those right now. As for, you know, mosquito issues and odors and things like that, I don't have anything specific right now. But what we can say is that a pond like this is designed to collect water and dissipate it over a 40-hour period. And so you're going to have a lot more moisture there than what's on a dry hillside now. However, we don't anticipate it's something that's going to be holding so much water that it's going to be growing something like cattails. So I don't think you're going to end up with that type of you know, continuous biological
the marshy effect.
Yeah,
the
marshy effect.
Yeah. And, technically speaking.
Yeah. As far as like the high volumes, it's designed around two different storms: a 5-year storm, which is designed to do all this treatment for, and then also to be able to handle though up to a 100-year storm, so we don't just see that whole thing get washed away. And so that's the basis of a lot of the sizing of this. The maintenance right now, we're hoping that something like this will actually make maintenance a little bit easier. Right now, the maintenance in the AABC is it's quite difficult because we have curb and gutter in some sections. We have country-style ditch in others, rural-style ditch that, you know, isn't always contiguous past a lot of the driveways. Some of them have culverts through them. Some of them don't. Some of them, we haven't seen the culverts in a few years. A couple years ago, we went and dug a lot of them out. So we've got a number of different ongoing issues that take up some maintenance time as it is now. With something like these sump inlets, it is a new thing that we have to maintain, but it's replacing an old maintenance that wasn't very, wasn't all that practical. So as far as costs, we can go through that now if you'd like. We do have some numbers put together for that. And then we can also compare some of this compared to what the city of Aspen is doing. But one thing I would like to know is, as a rural county, we live under a different set of rules as does a lot of the municipalities. And that applies to all of our rules and regulations for stormwater runoff. Effectively, we don't have much of a standard to go by. And so by adopting this urban drainage design that Denver's put together, this is a pretty high standard. So, but to get to a little bit of the dollars and cents. In the spring, we talked about this project probably having a total budget about $2.8 million. We'll talk about the pedestrian features here in a few minutes, but with some of the stuff that we removed from that, we had a savings of about $130,000. This ponds and some of the appurtenances that would have to go along with it, we're looking at a cost of about $140,000. To add any of these downstream defenders, we're looking at about $70,000 a piece after they're installed. They're pretty spendy, you know.
After they're installed? To install them.
So with including installation price. If we wanted to start talking about your basic biological treatment, we're probably starting around that $50,000 range. So if we were to do something like the ponds, those appurtenances, and some of the biological treatments, really, when you're talking about a $2.8 million project, you're a little bit out of the wash by the time we took out some of the sidewalk and some of those other things. So the sump inlets are not a huge increase in price compared to a standard inlet. It's just a difference of a couple extra yards of concrete. And so that's kind of where that stands right now.
The other one question I'd ask is, what is going to be the access for any sort of maintenance or mucking out the pond every 20 years or something like that? How are you going to get in there?
Well, we have two routes that we can get in there right now. One is down the hill, which would be a little bit tricky going down the Stein Trail, but it's not undoable by any means.
With a bobcat or what type of equipment?
Yeah, or you know, we can winch down a backhoe or something like that. The other thing is it's not that far up the hill from the Aspen Consolidated Sanitation District, which has a gate out to the Stein Trail that runs along the river, and so it'd be a little bit of a shorter route up the hill. Same kind of deal. Just go up the trail to access that pond with a small to moderate sized piece of equipment to go muck that out.
Those are the access points.
We just have to ask for permission from the Consolidated Sanitation District to use their access. I don't think we'd have too much of a problem. They're really excited about seeing something happen here. As most of you know, over the last couple of years, there's been some of these higher intensity storms that you referred to earlier. They've actually created small landslides that have affected the way that they do business down at the sanitation plant. So. Really what we're looking for now is some direction to move forward with this concept with the ponds, and then see where you guys want to go with these with the idea of the biological treatments and the mechanical removal items.
And how about, is mentioned also the grant process?
Yes. I started putting together a grant that can go to the Healthy Rivers and Streams, and they haven't funded anything like this yet. We feel that it does fit well within their mission, and we can put together this grant application. We kind of held off now because we don't know if we have direction to move forward with the idea or if we're allowed to put it where we're proposing it yet, but we've got that ready to go in, and we can put that application in for any percentage of the costs that are associated with this type of treatment.
Are there any state grants available?
We haven't.
Through Water Quality Division, whatever.
I think you'd have to be an impaired stream listing first.
Well, thankfully we're not qualified.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a catch-22.
I may be able to add in, from a budgetary perspective, I think we'll be able to find a way to accommodate these alternatives. The real question is, I think, are we shooting at the right target in terms of what we're trying to accomplish and how we're trying to accomplish it? Is this the type of thing we should be trying to build our next year's work plan, particularly for Public Works? The AABC is the major project, I think, that's planned, if you can call it one project, for Public Works next year. We had originally budgeted $2 million. Obviously, this option brings us up to 2.6 million potentially with some ins and outs. That we think we can accommodate. It's making sure that we're accomplishing what the board's intentions are that I think is a real question.
I think last time we talked about this, I think we all agreed that having a water retention pond is a critical component for addressing all the runoffs and the water drainage issues at the Airport Business Center to help preserve the health of the river. So I'm certainly very supportive of that. I'm a little hesitant in terms of looking at the idea of a downstream defender, certainly at the cost, and we haven't really talked about the lifespan of that, but that could be something perhaps we could look at down the road. Mm-hmm. But that may be something we don't really need to invest in at this point.
But does it not make sense, though, to get a take-off on costs so we understand what the whole package is at the end of the day, including, which we must go to, the sidewalk conversation, because we've only got about 20 more minutes, guys. So, Board, is that okay if we get costs? And, John, when do you propose that we would actually have some numbers or make that actual decision point, because I think we can sense the direction is we want to protect the stream to every bit of quality water we can.
And I think it would be appropriate to continue these discussions as we get into our budget. So we have to have a proposed budget in front of you by October 15th. I think I need to look. It's either the 11th or the 15th that we'll actually be bringing that initial budget to you, and then just like last year, we're going to work through the different core areas of the strategic plan, including going through our capital plan. And at that time, I think since this is probably the biggest expenditure in our road and bridge program, public works next year, we'd spend some time coming back to this and breaking it out for you.
Good. We also have a few tools. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to ask. One, I like the idea of Rachel saying about a matrix of these costs, because I think one of the things you're asking us is pond and defender, just pond, and seeing that broken out into the benefit of those individual aspects and how they would help stream quality and comparing them to cost. Two questions that I don't think have been asked yet. One is the safety issue of this pond. I mean, what do you put a 12-foot fence around it so kids don't play in it, because there is a lot of traffic of people trying to get to the Rio Grande Trail, that sort of stuff, and how Open Space and Trails is going to plan a trail system around this pond, and what cost is that built into the cost elements that we're looking at here as well, because obviously we need to reroute that Stein Trail is always been, that access down to the Stein Trail has always been problematic in terms of the existing drainage, so it'll be better going forward, but it's not that great a trail as it is, and I know that the AABC is desperate for better access to the Rio Grande Trail, and a $5 million bridge may not be the solution to that. So.
Well, Rob, one thing I tried to touch on, and I guess I didn't do a good enough job earlier, was when we look at rebuilding the pipe that goes from the ABC down to the river, one of the things that we do need to do is rebuild part of that trail just because of the construction activities that we'll be undergoing. Luckily, adding in some spots some crusher fines as the surface treatment on the top really isn't a huge expense at all. As far as the rerouting of the trail, what we have on there is really, once you get to there's a small flat area on the trail as it exists now just below the stairs, and basically that would just be rerouted if you're going down the hill to the right, and that's that little U-shape red mark there. And we don't have anything as far as, fencing or anything like that around the pond. I don't know.
We propose gradual slopes, so it's something you can walk on once it's re-badged, and it's not a steep slope, it's a gradual slope, more like 3-to-1 or 4-to-1 slopes.
If I may, I know that from the city's retention ponds, I had raised the concern about liability, or what if it's freezing in the winter and someone falls through and things like that, and had our staff kind of look at it as, is it a attractive nuisance and things like that, and I think you really don't have to do the 12-foot fence type of thing to be safe. We could reassure that with our attorney, but generally some sort of split rail fence that says, you know, this is a retention pond, it's, you know, not the cleanest water, thank you for avoiding it, you know, is generally enough for protection. But I do think that we may want to look into whether or not rebuilding the trail would trigger Americans with Disability Act, and whether there would be different slope requirements that we have, and requiring more switchbacks. Mm-hmm. You know, an older trail is not subject to it, a new trail may be. And so we'd have to, you know, work with ComDev and see where that lies.
Okay, we can check in with the open space and trail staff also. We've talked to them preliminary about that, but we'll definitely revisit that. And talking about those pedestrian connections kind of is a nice segue into our next portion. We looked at a number of different sidewalks last time that we visited. So we have a lot of traditional sidewalks, you know, the behind curb style. Today we'll also talk quickly about some pedestrian pathways, which is more of an at-grade, made of asphalt on the surface of the road, kind of like what we did with Red Mountain, just something separated from traffic for safe passage. We'll also take a look at what existing trails we have around here and how that connectivity between those is facilitated, between the Stein, the trail that goes into Aspen, and also a lot of those informal connections that are made through the AAVC. And then also we've got to mark the proposed trail that goes over Deer Hill to Burlingame.
Over or around?
Kind of around. So
okay.
There's some grade to it. So
we need to be very careful. At least some of us are real sensitive. It needs to go around Deer Hill.
Well, and because this map is at such a scale, I'm going to try to pull up the PDF right now.
I'm going to take my glasses off.
All right, so this is the section that we were looking at earlier with the pond. We have, obviously, the Stein Trail here. To the north, we have the North 40, which generates a decent amount of pedestrian traffic. Also, we have the 500 Road, or Baltic Avenue, where we still have proposed a traditional sidewalk. That traditional sidewalk would run in front of the row houses and then switch sides as we move to the west to down in front of, there's an architectural office here, and then this is Roxy's right here. And it would run it along this side. This is the by far the most high volume traffic area that we have for both pedestrians and for vehicles. And to us, it really made sense to facilitate that with a traditional sidewalk with a nice separation between traffic and the pedestrian, and to give them a little bit of protection. And it also would tie in nicely to our existing sidewalk along the frontage road, or the 100 road here. Also, what we have displayed here, all these yellow connections here are what we looked at. Those are more of the informal connections that people make throughout the AABC. The blue line here runs the length of the 300 road. The 300 road was a big concern because with constructing the full width and putting that sidewalk behind the curb and gutter, well, there was a lot of mature trees that would have to be taken out to facilitate that. There's also some concern from the community out there that they have, some of them maintain some irrigation systems for those trees too that we'd have to get into.
One thing, would you go back just a second? Let's see, Roxy's, right? Here's Roxy's.
Yes.
Is this follow that line in the parking lot that abuts to the commercial, the other buildings here, and would you lose parking spaces?
You wouldn't necessarily lose any parking spaces. This is on the Roxy's side of the road, and right now there's a little bit of an island there that's got some trees and small trees and some grass in it. And we propose,
so there is an island.
Yeah, so there's an island right there that we can utilize some of that space. It would go across that really wide entrance here where you have the parking lot next to the liquor store, and then continue on back towards the back roads of the ABC.
Is that identified here as the only actual formal traditional curb and gutter project?
Yes. right now we've gone back and forth with the community, and we're still visiting with them over, one, whether or not we have room in the 400 road is one concern. Two is we don't necessarily, now that we've revisited, think it's always it's necessary back there, because we do have a gate and that we will be keeping on that back road to separate that traffic. And since you basically just have people backing out and then just going that half block or so, separating those pedestrians from the traffic isn't absolutely necessary. We can try to integrate something like we'll look at on the 300 road, which is that at grade. I'm going to quickly just touch on the south part of that of the map, and then we'll move on to the next couple of slides. The 200 road, we're also talking about having this pedestrian pathway as an at-grade type of thing. And that would connect this the Into Aspen trail, the bike trail that goes from the ABC into town. This connection here that you see is where the potential Deer Hill Trail would connect in, near the above the storage units here and next to the Deer Hill condos. It would run also along this back 200 road and connect into, there's a trail easement up here that's used a little bit that connects into the Stein Trail. And so what we're really looking at here is putting these amenities in so that you enhance that connectivity, you know, basically from the north to the south throughout the ABC. You're always going to have a lot of the existing things connect the kind of the east to the west direction. And so what we'd be doing is really just kind of supplementing what's been working for them in the past and giving the people that do walk along the roads there and a better place to do so.
What had, for example, on 400, no, 200, is there parking displaced? What happens to all the illegal parking out there?
Well, on the 200 road, luckily we don't have too much.
I'm talking about the whole ball of wax, because it's more illegal than legal, I think.
Well, on the 300 road, last time we visited, we did talk about the parking and the need to legalize some of the parking and supply that. What we're going to do by doing that, though, is we're going to take away a lot of creativity to people. On the 300 road, one of the things that we'll get to here in a moment is to facilitate this pedestrian pathway, not take as many trees as what we were looking at. We eliminated some of the diagonal parking on one side of the road. I think it was the east side of the road.
You use the pointer because I really don't know where you're talking about.
This is the 300 road
up
here.
Okay, thank you.
And it's kind of what connects that and the 100 road, which is the frontage road, is what connects the AABC north to south. On the 300 road has been probably the more studied component of the project, because we did have a lot of impact back there. We did propose at one point to do one-way traffic, parking on both sides of the road with sidewalk. What we'll move to here is an at-grade pedestrian pathway on the roadway, eliminate parking on one side of the road, which was proposed for diagonal parking. That gets us a lot of width back. We can then facilitate two-way traffic, parallel parking on the west side here of the road. So we still facilitate some parking and facilitate the pedestrian amenity and not have as big of a take, as wide of a template going through there. So it's not as as impactful. One of the big concerns that we've heard about the parking situation is a lot of people thought that we needed to add some parking into the ABC, but they didn't necessarily want to see too much. They want to see some of that burden put onto the businesses themselves. They also didn't want to help facilitate illegal parking or long extended parking for people that might be using the airport across the street. So we feel like this whole concept for the 300 road really speaks to all those different aspects. It accomplishes gaining some legalized parking. It facilitates a pedestrian pathway and a good connection from the north to the south through the AABC. And it also facilitates some of our concerns about impacts to the trees and that through there.
Rachel? Yeah. This is is a little of an anomaly because it's a somewhat urbanized area within the county. And I'd have to, you know, have some research done with John Neely or ComDev. But do we currently have a snow removal ordinance requiring properties to remove the snow from in front of their properties?
Not that I know of.
I mean, I think that that's something we would really need to consider quite seriously before we go forward with this. I don't want to build a sidewalk that then becomes an ice path. And I also don't want to see the county taking on the maintenance requirement. But within the city, you know, business owners, property owners are required to clear the sidewalk in front of their residents within X time period of a snowfall. And, you know, to me, the primary need is often in the winter when you don't want someone with a baby stroller in the slush pushing, you know, in the middle of the roadway because there's no path. And so that, you know, that's a key component to even wanting to endorse a sidewalk plan.
So let's qualify that. Just one second, George. There is a kind of an at-grade existing roadway component, which I think we would maintain that element. But you're talking about curb and gutter sidewalks.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, if we can pile the at-grade sidewalk at the same time we pile the regular roads, that's fine. But I'm just saying it has to be thought about because you can't have people clearing their sidewalk and then having our plow dump snow back on the sidewalk and vice versa, you know. Or, you know, so that's just part of making it work when it goes into place.
Yes, George.
Yeah, just to follow up on Rachel's comments, you know, currently there is an ongoing problem out there every winter, as you know, just along that main stretch of the road. With the frontage road, mm-hmm. where that sidewalk in the wintertime, it's very, very rarely cleaned off. And I don't know who even cleans it off, whether we do as a county or the Airport Business Center office does. But that's been a problem for many, many, many years. And I know I brought this up prior as well as part of that problem. And again, I'm not sure if it's a county responsibility or will be Raptor's responsibility, but the Down Valley bus stop, which will be moved a little up valley with a new BRT station to get from there down to that frontage road and the sidewalk has always been treacherous going up and down that in the wintertime especially. So again, who is ultimately going to be responsible for that? I think we need to designate that and make sure that that gets done, because otherwise, you're right, it's great in the summertime, but for 5 months a year, it's really a hazard.
Mm-hmm. I can touch on some of those concerns right now. And as it stands, I believe a lot of the time that existing sidewalk along the 100 road is cleared by, I think it's actually city staff when they clear the trail that leads up to it. They'll turn around there, and I think that's why sometimes it's cleared, sometimes it's not. Behind traditional sidewalk that we're really proposing right now would be along the Baltic Avenue section. As you've correctly assumed of this, at-grade can actually be taken care of with our normal snow removal operations because it's at-grade. They're going to need to push that snow past there anyhow. I think that this, as far as George is concerned, from the bus stop down, that's something that we are talking about with RAFTA and CDOT with maintenance agreements, and that's something that would be good to bring back. I think you're right in that we don't necessarily have any ordinance at this time, and so that would be another good follow-up topic to come back with is how to treat that sidewalk. Luckily, we're only talking about a pretty short section here, so hopefully it's not too insurmountable, but...
But then, of course, there are two. There's the new proposed and what George is talking about,
right.
And that's a whole package we'll have to face.
Right. The interesting thing about, we can get into this when we talk about it, is all this sidewalk that's existing isn't necessarily in front of any businesses or anything. It's along the greenbelt. So kind of... To wrap up some of the sidewalk conversation, as we've been talking, traditional sidewalk behind a curb. This is a rendering of that 500 road extending back to the back 400 road. We install crosswalks through here to help facilitate the change of side. We wanted to change side because we need to preserve this existing parking here, which is utilized by both the daycare center and all this all the housing back here. Here's a little bit of a broader view of the AABC, and again, you can see that we have some that's going past the Roxy's. Unfortunately, in this one, we accidentally deleted the 100 road, but that would maintain. One of the things I want to talk about with the pedestrian pathways, we can treat something like that at grade like they do a lot of the new bike lanes, and that can be striped, it can be painted, it can look however we want it to look. We can make it look pretty nice. We can really kind of delineate that separate space for vehicles and for pedestrians. So this is just an example of how they've done a treatment like that. This is actually a bike lane, but we can do the same thing with any sort of pedestrian pathway.
I remember the last time we talked about this a while ago, and one of the ideas in terms of having a sort of an informal connections, rather than doing sidewalks all over the place, which mm-hmm. we narrowed that down, was just to throw some planters along some of these roads to designate a more clear path for pedestrians and for bicyclists. Are you still looking at that idea?
Well, we can delineate this however we want. Really what we're looking at, what I want to do is just say, this is at grade right now. As far as aesthetic treatments and things like that, we can get into those details later. But what I really wanted to see is just kind of a good direction to move forward with this sort of concept for the 200 and 300 road. We can bring back any sort of design details that the board wants to see about that. I'd like to steer away from a lot of things in the road for maintenance standpoint because they tend to be well maintained for the first couple years and then they get forgotten about, or we get the first snow too early and they get hit by snow plows and things of that nature.
Yeah, GR, you should be starting to wrap up your presentation.
Absolutely.
And make sure you specifically focus on what you need from us.
Okay. Well, I think we've hit on a lot of the things. We're really looking for direction in that stormwater treatment that we had, and I think that we've got some direction now. We can bring back during the budget talks a menu. We gave you some prices. Today, we'll put that in with the whole project. We do have some tools also. So if the board decides to fund at a certain level, we can bid this out with a couple options. We can bid it out with an alternative for these downstream defenders and things like that, and delete them from the project if they don't come in within budget. So that's also another option. We're looking for support for the pedestrian plan that we went over, and deleting some of those sidewalks, putting in these at-grade types of pedestrian pathways along the 300 and 200 road.
Yeah, I like what you've done of really limit the curb and gutter sidewalks and have more of a, and I think it's actually more of a rural, but in that urban center mm-hmm. feel of having the on-grade. And I'd be very concerned about the maintenance of traditional sidewalks all over the place. So for me, the direction is good. Board? Rachel?
Well, at least from the visual, and you know, I do apologize, I was not at the work session when this was first discussed, but is it a hard line or a rolled curve? Was a rolled curve sidewalk eliminated for some reason? You know, because that tends to have more of the rural feel than a hard edge.
Huge amount of trees, Rachel, that had to...
No, I'm just talking about where the sidewalk is still proposed for. Does it need to be the picture in our...
Well, right now we're proposing a vertical curb. You do have options of doing a roll, which is more of a mountable curb, as they refer to it.
Yeah.
I think what we're proposing is going more vertical. One is you get more drainage capacity associated with that, so it helps with your drainage conveyance on that. It's a lot of it depends if you're putting in mountable curb, it's for accesses. Well, we were proposing on specific access points for driveways and stuff would have a typical apron So it'd be a cut-down curb, and then beyond, in between the driveways, would be a vertical curb. So that's what we're proposing, and sometimes that's aesthetics for people.
Yeah. You know, Jack, again, just generally for me, I know we have a lot of people from the business center, and we did start a little late because we were running late. Maybe I'd like to hear what they're thinking about the plan as opposed to just me thinking about the plan. And
the housing discussion will be shorter, I think, than an hour.
Okay. So board, is that okay if we extend a bit?
Just one other quick comment. I'm supportive of this. Actually, a week ago, we had a presentation from Roxy's as a land application. I specifically asked them to work with you because we were very concerned about how their expansion was going to potentially bring in more business, which I'm sure they expect, but to address the pedestrian safety, especially with all the traffic flow and the parking issues.
Absolutely. We've had conversations with those folks, and they've been supportive of the sidewalk out in front, and they said that they'd be coming to talk to us about any other work that has to be done there to facilitate that movement of traffic.
GR, also, there's that open space component, which you indicated when we have our joint meeting we'll face, so, you know, obviously make sure that's on the agenda for that time. The board is inclined to take some public comment. This is a work session, so it's really not a formal piece of what we're doing here. I'd like to open it up for some very brief comments, honestly. You know, we could go on for hours. You all have had a master planning process plus this process integrated with that. So we'd like what amounts to more of some topical comments, please. Who would like to speak, if anyone? Start off here.
From our perspective,
you identify yourself.
Rob Snyder from the Aspen Business Center office. Our main concern has always been the amount of trees that were slated for removal under the first plan that we saw. I mean, the whole concept in the business center was developed and approved was, you know, heavily landscaped area, have the trees mature, make the buildings go away, which essentially that's been the result. And I like the fact that this plan backs off on a lot of the tree removal and retains a lot of the mature trees that would be really tragic if we lost. So we're supportive in the direction this is going.
Yeah, thank you, Rob. Anyone else? Richie.
I just wanted to comment as a neighbor, being a resident at the North 40, where we have roll curbs through the whole subdivision. And while it's parking, we don't allow parking on those streets. It's inevitable that roll curbs add just a little tilt to the car. And I can see a situation where we will have unlimited parking available throughout the business center if you're going to put roll curbs in. I mean, it's just something to think of. And the streets are great until the trucks park on those curbs. So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Any other comments, please?
Sir, please identify yourself. Harlan Hemphill. I live on the 400 road out there. I feel that the sidewalks on the 400 road really not necessary as long as the gate remains to keep the flow of traffic to a minimum on the residential side. And we'd lose so much trees if we went through there and put in a 5-foot, I'm assuming it would be a 5-foot sidewalk. And also on the 500 road, which is the most congested, we definitely do need sidewalks, without a doubt.
Thank you. Any further comment? Seeing, sir, please identify yourself.
I'm Mark Littlefeller. I'm one of the commercial landlords out there. I thought I should just let you know, John McBride and Rob, who works for him, and some others have sort of put all of the commercial landlords together, and we've formed a very informal sort of, we want to call it a caucus or a board or something, among the people who are sort of the executives of that board is myself and there are four others, John Clark, John McBride, of course, and I think maybe somebody from the Steve Company. In any case, my point is that we're very supportive of this project. And GR and Brian have done a great job communicating with us. And then personally, as one of the owners of the 210 building, it's high time.
Well, thank you. And we certainly have had a cooperative effort going back with, of course, the staff, Public Works, et cetera, and our consultants. And we thank everyone. Board, is there any further comments or clarifications? Seeing none.
Sorry, Jack. You know, I do think it's worth investigating. Would the water quality side, would a grant from the Healthy Rivers and Stream Fund be appropriate? This is just, to me, it seems to fall within some of it, not a large amount of the project, but if we're taking it from a level far beyond what our EPA requirements are and our current conditions are, it may be appropriate. I know that was passed, including the term water quality, improving water quality. And so, again, I don't see it as going in. I think it'd be inappropriate to ask for all of this because it, perhaps that's where the extra removal equipment comes from or something like that. But I think we should use it as an opportunity to raise the bar and set a good example for how you retrofit older developments to more modern understanding of water quality needs.
George, you could make application and then it has to go. And I think it would also be a benefit just to touch base real quick with John Healy.
Mm-hmm. And,
see where how it's measured, because I think a partial grant might be very appropriate. Okay, it looks like we're done with this item. Thank you, everybody.
Thank
Great
you.
Job.
Thank you.
Are you having fun? Those I feel better. What are you doing? Miss my reading?
No.
See? I could guess that one. I have a surprise to see you.
Lock doors around here, it wouldn't take extra time. Okay, we're here again at our September 18, 2012 work session. The next item is a joint housing work session preparations discussion.
Thank you, Jack. John Peacock, County Manager. We had originally actually set aside this time mostly for Colin Laird, who is going to be facilitating the work session to discuss the agenda and potential outcomes. Unfortunately, Colin has come down ill today and is unable to make it. That's why I indicated this may be a shorter discussion than we had originally planned during our previous item. But what I would like to do is a couple of things. One, my apologies, I did not catch in the agenda, I had meant to remove that there would be two attachments, being the agenda and also the strategic review of housing. Those items are almost done. They are not done yet. We do have a draft agenda that I'm going to hand out to you here in a minute. You'll see several changes from last time we discussed this. And I also wanted to at least hand out right now the table of contents so you can get an idea of what's going to be in that strategic review of housing. Both of those documents should be finalized and we should be able to distribute them to you by Friday. There are just a few items that city staff is working on finalizing and getting compiled into what is turning into a rather large PDF file for you guys to review. I'd also like to acknowledge we have Adam Frisch from the Aspen City Council here. I think, Adam, I don't know if you had specific comments you're open to make or if you wanted to just be here in case questions came up or...
2 minutes of stuff, I guess, real quick.
Alan, why don't you, even though we all know you for the audience, introduce yourself.
Adam Frisch, Aspen City Council, member of the Housing Frontiers Group. So for better or worse, I think this has kind of started from my idea in 09 and 11, talking about one of our most important community assets being the housing program, and that it seemed to be jointly managed, which I think is really important. But that happened from elected officials 15 minutes every 3 months in our when we get together quarterly. And I felt that there was a gap, and I think a lot of people agree, in kind of making sure we had the time to check in to see what the community was working on, thinking I don't think it had been looked on too seriously since 2007, and before that, probably not since the inception when it started in the early 70s. And so... I think, I'm not sure how the word summit got in there, but it obviously gave a lot of people heartburn, and I don't blame anyone, because it's a dirty word in government speak as well as for the community. And the idea was really just to kind of have a focused time where the council, the AFSCME board, and you guys could all sit down and kind of have a focused discussion on a couple of different topics. And I think we have four great topics to go over that I think are prevalent and relevant for the vast majority of people in the community, whether you live in that AFSCME housing program or not. And I think that as we were getting more and more focused, working with Phyllis and John and Barry from the city, there was an expectation, I think, kind of getting out there in the public that all of a sudden this was going to be the place where all the problems were going to be solved and checks were going to be written and votes were going to be taken. And I just want to make sure that we try to manage everyone's expectations. My idea, and I think where things are heading towards, is that we're going to sit around and talk about kind of one topic for half of a day, 2 days, four topics. Agree that we probably want to spend some time and effort focusing on those four. Talk about some possible solutions and pros and cons, but if we can get to that stage and then let others kind of veer off to do some work on it, whether it's staff or different boards or other kind of groups, and then come back with some suggestions, I don't think we want to try to solve anything or come up with any kind of final decision on October 11th or September 27th. So I think those are manageable goals, and I think it can be a very successful process, and I think hopefully it can lay a little bit of a groundwork next time that the two boards went together and kind of talk about something that's really important to the community, that sometimes just kind of 15 or 20 minutes here every other month or not even then is worthy, and kind of set up kind of a work session format where there can be a lot of relax, give and take, and I'm glad that Colin's going to come in there and help us facilitate some stuff. So that's all I really had to say. If you have any questions, that's great. If not, I'll let you go on with the rest of your meeting.
Yeah, sure. More of a comment. I agree with all that you said, Adam, and I want to thank you and the City Council for starting this discussion. In terms of the process, I agree that, you know, these are, I envision this as work sessions as well, and then bring some of those comments back to staff to work on and bring back to the both of the boards. But I want to make sure that happens in a timely fashion, because I think some of the things that we are will be discussing on the agenda are policy decision questions, and I don't want to prolong some of those issues. You know, for example, just the governance of the housing office. You know, I think that's something that we're all interested and concerned on from policy level. So I just don't want that to extend out months and months while we wait for information to go back and forth. That would be my only comment.
I'm about getting things done, so I hear you and support you. I'm not sure when the next time the two boards are meeting, but it might be too soon right then and there, but I'm hoping within the one after that, that we actually have some policy making and some votes cast and some things implemented. Because I think there's some really big questions that are just good to bring up, but I think there's some definitely manageable and tackleable and achievable goals that we can deal with about capital reserve and some of the guideline changes, and possibly get kind of empowering the APSHA board a little bit more, which I think will be helpful for everybody. And so we'll see how that plays out. But I hear you on getting things done. It's above just talking about it, but less than a full-on summit. We're going to get 100 people in a room. Obviously, everyone's welcome to attend. But the focus is really on your board, council, and especially as well as the APSHA board, to get around and have some discussions and try to figure out how we can accomplish some goals. So,
I don't know who had the hand up first, so please.
Thanks for being here.
Of course.
As well. And, you know, I just want to make sure we are not shorting these topics. You know, they seem, not only the list has gotten shorter, which I appreciate, but then also the description of them, because number four, to when we've discussed it, was always the governance of the housing efforts, but it was also the role of the housing office, you know, and, you know, maybe some people see those as the same thing, but, you know, even in your introductory comments, you referenced how little cohesion perhaps is behind the city and the county in the current structure, but that really only changed in 2001. I mean, that's when the housing office went in the city as a city department, and there were no longer board liaisons. But it used to be when there was a city rep and a county rep from the boards, there was much closer coordination and understanding. Of course, at that time, the role of the housing office was more of a development entity, and that's been taken away. And so from the county side, that's been a bit of a question, because we don't have the same type of capacity that you have within your asset management department to be developing a housing program. So to me, again, it's governance of the housing efforts and role of the housing office and the housing board and then, you know, other roles. So I just want to make sure we don't compact them down enough that we miss some of the bigger issues that we were all kind of interested in the first place. And then I'm just kind of questioning, I think I understand it, but I want to make sure I'm clear, that on these topics we'll have kind of bullet points or whatever, what the issues are surrounding those elements, what the pros and cons are, you know, how it's working or how it's not working, and then, you know, potential resolutions, and then allow room for us to brainstorm other resolutions and issues, so whether it's on the capital reserve policy or the role of retirement in our inventory and needs. Is that correct?
That's actually probably a good segue to talk a little bit about how the agenda is laying out right now, how we see the discussions going, and maybe getting a little bit more input, Rachel, from the board about what do you see as success, you know, coming out of these discussions. That's, I think, the type of feedback that Colin was going to be hoping to get today, and I'll do probably an inadequate but somewhat adequate job of standing in for him.
Can I just make one comment on Adam's comments before we jump into the agenda stuff, and kind of piggybacking on what George said, because I totally agree with you, Adam, that, you know, we can get bogged down with some minutiae in these things, and looking at the, you know, the three boards getting together and talking about ideas and those sorts of things. But I totally agree with George, and when we were doing work sessions about what sort of topics we would want on here and what sort of time frame and days, I really put out the thought process of, as you said, I'm a getting things done type of guy too, but to me that means putting a deadline on things, putting an extra meeting into things, and saying, well, we need another meeting on this topic, and I think we shouldn't be afraid to point that out while we're going through these 2 days, saying that this is an important topic and this is going to take a special breakout session. I don't want to wait to our quarterly meeting, which are generally pretty jam-packed with things. So we have to have someone that really identifies our decision-making policy decisions, and not necessarily making them during these 2 days, but realizing that they have to be made, they have to have a deadline to them, they have to have a time frame for staff to get stuff done, get back to us, and there has to be a moment where we say, well, we need to get back together and make these decisions and put them into effect.
I totally agree. I mean, there's 2,800 units out there, so it's a vast majority. It's a huge percentage and part of our community. And it's their city, you know, the real estate is, I'm not sure if it's $1 billion, but it's hundreds of millions of dollars. So this is a serious program that does not need to be rewritten, does not need to be scraped. There's definitely some improvements that I think we need to think about. And I think if we want to be responsible for that, we need to put the correct amount of time in that, and hopefully we can have these official, we can have very, very efficient meetings when we get together and kind of talk about it, and hopefully, and I'll be getting back to everyone in the council to make sure that they show up reading that briefing book that's about to come up. I haven't seen it yet, but there are some possible solutions that have been put in there, at least on the capital reserves and some other things. So, as I said, there's nothing in there that I expect to be ramrodded through, or just I'm looking for technical sign-off, but those are just ideas that have come up from the community. But hopefully we can try to figure out how to get it done. And I don't, I'd hate to waste the momentum of basically spending 16, 18 hours together over a couple weeks on something. And if that requires another 4 or 5 hours, and so be it. I think we owe it to the community. Thanks.
Rob, you good? Go ahead, John.
Thank you. Yeah, so first, on Friday, you're going to be receiving your document, the strategic review of housing. I've just given you right now the table of contents, so you can see what the scope and potential size of that document is going to be. It's going to be pretty beefy. You have about 50 pages of initial content, as well as a number of attachments. It'll probably be about 100 pages or so of background information when all is said and done. And the background information was designed really around the key issues that were originally identified and are on your agenda. There were 9 key issues originally identified, I think, through a discussion with Council Adam, that the city staff began building an agenda around. We had originally talked a lot about a summit, and we spent a lot of time, as Adam already said, talking about, you know, what did that mean in terms of what were we really trying to accomplish there. And as we, I think, had more and more discussions at the staff level and with elected officials, particularly with city council members, what really became clear is what we were really talking about initially was a joint work session to try and get our heads around what were those next steps that may then go out into the community. You know, the next steps that are identified and by the three bodies may be more appropriately dealt with by stakeholders, you know, a committee of stakeholders than city or county staff or such. We need to see where your discussions go. But at any rate, in talking about the concept of the work session, it really boiled down to 4 primary topics. You have the current and future demand for housing, retirement, and supply of housing for the workforce. That is the first topic on September 27th, followed by capital reserve studies and the maintenance of existing inventory, which would be the second topic on the 27th. And I'll come back a little bit to the structure.
Then on October 11th, we come back together again to talk about broadening the role of housing efforts in the community. That's a topic that we have particularly requested, about whether we're serving all segments of our community that we should be, with the right types of services and housing options. And then finally, finishing up with the discussion on governance, Rachel, that you had brought up. And we actually didn't narrow the specific topics on governance. We just summarized it in the memo there. As far as how we're seeing this, each of these sections right now, facilitated, one is, staff has taken on, different staff have taken on putting together the information that you're going to be seeing in the strategic review of housing. And so each of the four issue areas is going to start off with a brief presentation summarizing the materials that were presented that relate to that area. So for example, there will be a brief presentation highlighting some of the information on current and future demand for housing and retirement, and going over the statistics and trying to draw up the high points.
Emphasis on brief.
I think we have about a half hour or so scheduled. County staff will be taking lead on the presentation on, are we providing the right types of housing and services in the program? Is the program broad enough? That will be followed by discussion, and the discussion is really to clarify the information that was presented and also give onlookers, so we may have other stakeholders who are attending to track the discussions between the boards. We wanted to give an opportunity for those folks to be able to add or clarify information that was presented, so that you have an opportunity to hear from at least a brief opportunity to hear from interested members of the community. Then it really goes into a facilitated discussion amongst the three bodies, so APSHA, the City Council, and the Board of Commissioners, to try and answer some of the key questions and start to develop some broad policy direction. As we've all said several times, we don't have enough time to get into the details of how we're going to solve problems. But if we can take it as, what kind of goals are we wanting to achieve, and how do they differ from where we are now, so that we can hand that off either to staff or to a working group of stakeholders, and you have agreement on what those desired outcomes are for each of these areas as three bodies. If you can't get there, then that's obviously something we're going to have to step back and say, you know what, we need to schedule another 3 hours at some point very soon to unpack this a little bit more, get clearer direction. And that may happen with some of these, but the agenda is laid out, one, to make sure that we have a thorough backgrounding on each one of these four topics, so we're all starting with the same information and data, and we agree on at least that first run, and then we can take the next steps to see how much agreement we have as the three entities on how to move forward. So I guess I'd ask if you want to take a second and look through if there are any surprises or concerns about how we're approaching this joint work session at this point.
Well, while they're doing that, I'll mention that I think when this idea first came to us, at least two of the commissioners were skeptical about how this was evolving, and in particular the public element, etc. So I have to compliment staff of both organizations in honing this down and understanding and realizing that actually we were definitely in need of a work session instead of an open mic. Here we are, even though there were select individuals, even 50 were too many to have a conversation. So this is, I think,
has evolved in the right way, in that we're building a from a foundation, which is data and specific topics, and there's always the future, as we've talked.
And I appreciate that. I've used the word, it's not going to, it's always, you know, we want to include the public, but it's not going to be an open mic night. Having said that, there's a lot of outreach already going on and continue to do so over the next 12 or 14 days as far as through different computer programs to figure out social media and to kind of get input about where people are going on. There's been different meetings with ACRA, SCECO, the Aspen Democracy Initiative for the Young Whippersnappers getting together on Thursday to kind of hear. So there is outreach. The idea is trying to get that outreach and feedback prior to sitting down versus let's sit down and spend half the time talking about each person's specific issue or each individual HOA's specific issue. That is not the focus of the topic. But as John said, we need clarity before agreement. And if we focus on what the goals are going to be, other people can kind of bring us the tools that we might want to use. I don't want to get stuck in what size the grip, the hammer should be. That's not our, I don't think that's my role, I don't think that's your role, but I'll let you guys be the decision on that. So hopefully we can come up with some common goals that we want to see achieved and figure out which ones are legally allowable, politically viable, to make sure that we don't get mucked up and stuff just spinning around in circles again, because the worst thing is to have a bunch of great ideas that don't filter up, and that onus is on us to make sure that filters up, I think.
You know, we're past the initial smell test, as it were, legally,
yeah.
Even, as it were. Answer John's question, any feedback, adjustments? Rachel?
Yeah, when you see a table...
Identify the date if you are date specific.
Yeah, no, not date. I'm looking more at the table of contents here. But, you know, it's hard to tell from a table of contents what's woven within things and what's not. But I really want to make sure we don't somehow just take for granted or overlook the value of the affordable housing program. I mean, I realize that, you know, because we're going to be sitting here talking about the challenges, the problems, the issues, and I think that, you know, for our own consumption and the public consumption, it's important to remind yourself, what does it mean to have 2,800 units? What has that done for stability of the workforce or stability of businesses and vitality of the town? And, you know, I don't see that as a huge chunk of research or something, but I do think that that is an important component to be able to at least give it a nod in here somewhere and somehow. Maybe it's under existing affordable housing inventory. You know, why did the community start it? Has it kind of lived up to our expectations? What has it done for the stability of the workforce? And how much do these people living here contribute to our local economy and our attractions and resorts? So that's all. I just want to make sure we're not spending so much time focusing on what have grown to be issues, which any program will have. So that's my only feedback.
That's good. And we are coming from a place of strength overall,
yeah,
and
right,
relative to other communities. And you're right. We tend to focus on what is the problem, what are the issues, let's define it, and let's solve it. It can maybe sometimes lead to not appreciating what this community has accomplished. So that's well taken.
I, for example, Thursday, October 11th at 10:45, what is the right approach to the role of housing program in addressing community housing needs beyond workforce housing? So, I mean,
And so
I guess we'll let you give us a little feedback.
And so we're really kind of struggling with how to couch this the right way, because we kept talking about social services and housing, which wasn't really, in our opinion, the right question to be asking. The right question to be asking was, or we believe is, are we serving all segments of our community that should be served through an affordable housing program? And what you'll see in the background information that we prepared, Jack, is that for lots of good reasons, when you go from the IGA to the policy guidelines of action and, you know, to the purpose statements, what you see is a narrowing of focus to say, from the IGA, we're going to serve workforce, disabled,
low-income, elderly, but, you know, it's a very broad scope. And by the time you've narrowed it down through the policy statements, we're really focused just on workforce housing. And I think that made a lot of sense historically because, you know, how do you eat an elephant? It's one bite at a time, and that was the most, I think, pressing need, particularly when that fourth amended IGA and the guidelines were.
I don't think anyone thought they were going to retire in 1972 or sit down to write the program either.
And so, as a practical matter, what that's meant is as our demographics have shifted, and so you'll see, and you guys already know this, but we have an aging population. We've also had economic shifts where we've had a higher degree of unemployment and decrease in some cases in income and such. And so what that's done is it's changed the demographics and maybe who could be served by the housing program. The other thing that we identify is that there's some tools that we forego by not serving these populations, whether it be through housing and urban development or the state division of housing, to both help fund and place folks. And so we are going to present both the statistics and data about some of the things that have changed, obviously not everything, but some of the things that have changed, some of the other tools that are available to our housing program or to the governmental entities playing in the housing program, and just ask the question, you know, do we want to broaden our focus for who we should be serving and how we should be serving them? It may still be appropriate that we focus on workforce housing, but we think there may be other needs out there, and so that's going to be that discussion, Jack, is discussing it. Are we serving the right people, and should we be availing ourselves of other opportunities?
Yeah, are we asking this as a philosophical question, or are we asking as a practical one? I mean, we cannot be all things to all people.
Mm-hmm. I think we're asking.
We'll sift through that. I mean, I'm throwing out that as a rhetorical question, as it were.
And all throughout the rhetorical answer is yes. You know,
what was the question?
Yeah, right.
You know, not only, and if we do want to expand those that can apply, we probably need to come up with different financing options. But the existing ones we have now, how I think Mr. Ely and Mr. Chu read the law is that it is for people that are here to work or who were working. And if we want to expand that applicant pool for APSHA, we are probably going to have to come up with a different financing mechanism besides the rent or something else like that. And so, but until we get to that, let's figure out if we want to, you know, if we want to expand that. And it came from the county. I think it's a very, very valid discussion point.
And we'll present those financing tools because there are options on the table. What it takes is a different focus, and we'd have to develop different capacity and capabilities to take advantage of them.
Sure. Rachel.
Yeah, just following this conversation, I think that when we get to the attachments for the information packet, it would be good to include the ballot language that created the funding sources that the city has, and then whatever particular language is specific to our mitigation fees, because that's our primary source. I realize you have a mitigation as well. You can include that if you want. But, you know, I think that that is something that just to remind ourselves and the public what was the enabling language. The other thing that, you know, I guess strikes me as funny is that Thursday the 27th we're going to discuss the role of retirement, and then it's not until the 11th that we talk about the broader housing needs, and there's a crossover between those two. I mean, there just clearly is, and so I'm not so sure those aren't separated out in two different days, and they should be on one day. I'll just leave that for bigger minds than my own to resolve. But, you know, I've thought a lot about the retirement question in particularly. And, you know, I don't know what was in the minds of people who buying their first unit in 72 if they thought that one day I'll retire. I don't know how many people under 30 ever think about that they will age out and retire. But it becomes more clear as you get older. And so, you know, to me, part of the question is, you know, would we attract the right type of people for the jobs that we have if they knew, you know, I'm going to not be able to stay in this unit at a certain point in time. I'm expected to stay here for a while and then leave. If that ends up being a policy direction where it goes, I don't know. But, you know, some of our own policies are actually making this a harder problem. And I also don't know the solution to this, but I know we say you can't buy another home anywhere in the watershed. What if people who were over a certain age could buy a home in Glenwood Springs for their eventual move out? You know, are our own policies creating part of our problem, you know, that people would be able to do something? How do you do that equitably so that someone's not subsidized and they own free market and blah, blah, blah? But, you know, I think that is a question that really needs to be asked.
So on the agenda, I think the one thing that I think Phyllis and Barry were about, you know, should governance become first or last? But the point about should the retirement be in the same day as who do we serve is we can figure that out or whatever John and Barry and Phyllis want to do. I'm supportive of. There's a little bit of a jigsaw puzzle to do that. So.
Sure. As I say, let others continue to work on that.
But this is the question or the point that Rachel made is a very sensitive, complex issue for many people, of course, in housing. We understand community needs, but I hope there's recognition also of the long-term value of employees who work, and maybe there's an undercurrent, or at least by raising the question, then some people, and I've been asked, actually I was at a kind of a wedding celebration this weekend, and there is some of that networking questioning going on, and one individual asked me about the future of retirement in the program, and I said, well, it's my understanding, and of course we have to have the discussion, but we're not talking about booting people out just to make room. And I think, and the reason why I say it's complex, because that's a legal question also. And the guidelines that you signed up on, to my understanding, dictates what goes on.
I'll say this. I don't want to prejudge what we're talking about, but there is no way that this community is going to kick anyone out. Having said that, legally we can't even do that. APSHA is really, it sometimes I think is messed even, it took me a couple of years to figure out. APSHA is really just a clearinghouse of applicants that come in. Those HOAs are independent, nonprofit organizations. They have their own guidelines, and all the rules that there are a lot of rules and regulations I would love to change if I could wave a wand over them, and we'd have a lot more efficiency. But the legal structure was set up that those are individual, owned and operated and managed HOAs, and it's their responsibility to live in them. And for that, the city and the community has a very limited amount of tools that they can do outside of inducement, voluntary inducement, to see things change, as it is to, if you have someone who started off with three kids in a three-bedroom and now they're by themselves, and how do you maximize that? And that there's no, you have to move with that. It's going to be about, is there a financial enticement or some other kind of enticement to get people to kind of move into a smaller place? And so I want to make sure that I appreciate that, but there's no kicking out of people, even if the community wanted to, which of course we don't. There's a lot of, the current owners have a tremendous amount of power, and that's how it was set up. And that might change a little bit in some of the capital reserves for the newer projects going forward. But I don't ever see a time limit being placed on how long, the assumption is you buy it. The plan was in the 70s that you're going to live in there for 3 years, save your money, and then step up to the free market. And then what happened was after a certain amount of years, the free market just ran away.
The market went so far ahead that you didn't catch up in a lifetime.
So now you have a very small percentage of the people actually doing it. It is happening, especially when they go down to the SALT, which is a double-edged sword for the community, for the valley.
That's the only other question I'd have for the board is if there's any additional comments as to, and I think I've gotten some, but what does success look like for you coming out of this? What would it look like to have you leave thinking that was time well spent and we're moving the needle?
Well, for me, it would be just to have some clear direction to have a policy discussion on these issues or any other issues that come up. At least if not new policies, a clarification of existing policies.
Okay.
one more comment before I answer that question is, in talking about, and this gets back to the retirement issue and the first day, it's really about current and future demands, needs, and desires. What's the proper balance that we want here? And the word that's not in that section that I think needs to be somewhere in the discussion is the word of like community balance. You know, I mean, we can have a workforce housing that lives 80 miles away and all comes up here, but it doesn't create a community here. Mm. And that's a big part of where the demand flow is, and that's where the retirement issue is in that section, because it relates to how many people are working, how many people are actually part of our community. You know, just because someone's not working, it doesn't mean that they're not a part of our community, because there's a huge volunteer base from those people. There's a huge nonprofit, you know, aspect to those people. And it's really about what we want to create. The, you know, 2 years ago, everybody was throwing out that term that by this date, we want this many people that work here, living here. And it's kind of gone away, that you know, what that percentage should be. But I think a big part of what our community housing is about community. You know, you look at Vail's demographic of, what, 200 people living in Vail that work there or something like that, and our demographic where we have, you know, 2,000-3,000 employee housing units within our community. So that's an important issue for that topic. But to answer your question, because as we're running down on this hour, you know, I get back to what I said before and totally piggyback off of what George is saying. I think what the goal of this is really identifying where there needs to be policy changes, not necessarily making them then, but defining, you know, the highlights of where the future work is, and having an open, honest discussion about where we feel you know, the right balance is in these topics.
Yeah. Two comments. One is that on the attachments, we should also now include the AACP housing chapter, which isn't down here as an attachment. Maybe it's within the other topics. But, you know, kind of what the current work was, or those wonderful lead-in statements, which refer to a lot of the original purpose of housing. So maybe it's under the purpose section. Example of success to me would be really understanding the interrelationship of these topics. Almost nothing happens by itself. So community need, workforce, retirement, categories, you know, mix, unit mix, everything's interrelated. So understanding that interrelatedness is important. You know, having all out on the table, these pros and cons, you know. So when we have a future housing discussion on whatever it may be, it's not that somebody says, well, what about this aspect of it? No, I want to at least get the aspects out on the table, and we could all weigh them individually as to what are the most important or least important or whatever. But I think that, you know, ending the circular conversation that goes around and around again is important to me, so that when you're talking about retirement and housing, or capital reserves and capital maintenance, you know, we've at least really gotten all the interrelationships out, the pros and cons out, the challenges out, you know, and so then we can move a policy forward that's built on a really sound foundation, that we all agree on the same foundation going forward. So I see those as important. And, you know, perhaps part of it, maybe this is asking too much or thinking too much, but a little bit about what is our allocation going to be going forward, whether it's allocation, are there funds to create a revolving loan fund at a low interest rate for capital repairs? Is that, should that be an allocation of our housing resources? Should making sure more units are bought down to 2 and 3, should that be an allocation of our resources? You know, that type of thing, so that it gives us the basis for good allocation models in the future. Yeah, even though they're just guidelines.
For me, well, no, let me ask a question to clarify. Fourth bullet, first page of just the topics, key issues. Fourth bullet from the bottom, maintenance of existing housing stock
how do we ensure role of government, money? Are we not talking about for sale? Because we know what the role of government is in maintaining the first, the rentals. You know, that's the responsibility. They do that with a capital plan, accessing, you know, supported by rents, et cetera, and the mutual budgets, as it were. So, you know, that, to me, that point is for sale, am I correct?
Jack, I think you're reading that.
No, it's obvious it needs to be stated, I think.
Yeah, I go back and forth with Barry on this. I think some of those key issues belong in actually one of the four topics, and I think about most of them actually belong really in one of the four. That one is a capital reserve issue, I think the role is to assist and help, but not get into the direct payments of the capital reserve thing. I think that's where most of the community is. Having said that, whatever we all 15 of us want to talk about, we'll talk about. But that's usually. But it is based on the ownership standpoint. So the rental units are obviously are managed and overseen and financed for repairs by AFSCME.
Yeah, and so I certainly would agree with whatever 15 talk about, you know, with staff. But for me, then I'll go on to what success is. Success is identifying the specific areas where we need to evolve or change, modify. Quite frankly, I think most of things are not individual pieces, but the major pieces moving forward with the housing program are pretty decent shape. I do understand with some board members there's some take issues with the evolution of the governance and how that, you know, so we'll have that discussion. But for me, success, as I've just said, is that evolution or where we might be headed to change while maintaining an understanding of what's realistic. You know, the capital, we use that as an example. Well, if money grew on trees, then they'd pick it, you know, the individual associations would pick it off the trees themselves. So the role of government, what it is, and we're not going to have that conversation here. But we got to recognize that when I say practical, the practical side is, as you said, Adam, each of these are individual associations with their own, you know, operations and their own responsibilities. So that's why I say we've got to keep our, you know, feet on the ground, as it were. Not that we can't, you know, shuffle, you know, to understand where we might be headed. But it's a very serious issue, I see, that people were not responsible a long time ago, and therefore they're not able as the product is aging. So that's going to be one of the biggest challenges we have, I see, in how to deal with this.
No, that's why it's one of the four.
Sure. So under the, I hate to keep going back to the information booklet, but whether it's under planning for the future, indications of current demand, we'll have kind of like recent sales, you know, what has been the sales over the past couple of years, and what is the current for sale, and what is the experience of AFSCME with it? It's not just the inventory, it's kind of what the market's doing.
The retirement issue really came up because it's not that how do we open them up, but just realization that a lot of the supply of the housing product is being used by a growing percentage of retirees.
Yeah.
And if we want to have the next generation come in, we need to figure out how to either induce people to leave because we're not going to do it, nor should we or can we do it legally. And the chances of building just a lot more physical buildings from a space and money and people's community about balance between open space and everything else just isn't there.
Right. No,
so the question is how, that's kind of where the retirement issue came about. And I'm not, you know, I'm not sure there's any.
And I wasn't even back to the retirement issue. I was about current, what have the sales been like, and you know, how long have things been on the market, and
And so the city's done a nice job. We had done a presentation for you all following your February retreat when we came back and went through each one of the six areas, and we had presented some short analysis, you know, demographics and sales and those sorts of things, but. the city's done is really taken that kind of analysis and put a lot more information to it. So I think you're going to get a lot more detail about, you know, what percentage do the categories make up in terms of sales and those sorts of things. So, yeah.
I mean, that's just been one of my things. Everyone's heard it before, but, you know, how much do you do on new if you have unsold older units? Is there a problem there? Is there not a problem there? Do they eventually take care of themselves? And, you know, I don't know if we were ever able to get to this. And maybe it's a policy going forward, but I really think we should begin a process of doing some exit inventory, you know, exit interview type of thing. So, you know, and because I've mentioned this at my little building at Hunter Creek, I've seen a number of the neighbors pass away who were in retirement, and I've seen others decide to move away who were in retirement. And so I know there's a growing number of people in retirement, but do we think everyone who's going to retire is, quote, an issue? Or is there some natural attrition that occurs? I mean, how much does it sift out for itself? And is it a demographic bump that we need to worry about with the baby boom and our traditional buyers? Or is it a long-range issue? Is it something that will sort itself out over the next 20 years? Or does it become an ongoing issue? And so, you know, I just think that there's a lot surrounding that issue that I don't think I have a full grasp on, and I don't want to be working off of my own anecdotal experience at my one building in Hunter Creek. So,
okay, well, if there are no further comments, I want to thank Adam, John, for the presentation, feedback, and we'll just evolve this to a very refined point, and then we'll be all over the place when we get to the work session.
Yeah. Thanks for writing hard on this.
Yeah, we'll see you no later than next Thursday.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Wilson.
Okay.
Board, are we ready for a break?
I think we're set up for a break.
And how long? You know,
15.
Okay. That's what it says, but I want to make sure.
Great.
Since I tried to stretch lunch a little bit.
Yeah.
Initial feedback for us?
The memo says September 28th. It is October 1st, as you've indicated, Jack. That was, as we were moving around, an error. We are going to be meeting the Gunnison County Commissioners in Redstone, is the game plan on that day. We had talked about two potential topics earlier, and I've had a discussion with their county manager about one other that they're interested in. But we had previously talked about just an update on oil and gas. You know, Gunnison County in particular has been pretty active in developing and testing new regulations and relationships with the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission. So we, as staff, were suggesting just an update on their latest efforts and what they've learned to inform any future discussions we have. And then also we have a common interest in the Crystal Trail, and the connection from Redstone to Crested Butte, and just some of our common challenges there. The third item that Gunnison County is interested in is an update on what we've been doing with our broadband project. You're going to be getting an update next week on our progress in mapping cell service and broadband, or cell internet, as well as voice services, and what we've learned in that process. And they're pretty interested in getting an update. I think that similar type of update on what our activities have been. So I wanted to see if there are any other topics that the board would be interested in, and if these three are the three that I've mentioned are appropriate.
Look, John, on the broadband, though, question, is 3/4 an hour enough for staff to present what they need? And if not, it looks like we have some blank time, you know, just an awareness.
On future agendas.
Yes. And we do have some changes to that agenda.
Okay, so we'll deal with that later. Rachel?
Well, I was just a little lost because you said there are three topics, and maybe I was distracted, but our memo already says broadband, so I don't see that as a new third, and oil and gas. So we only
Crystal Trail.
Okay, there we go.
And actually, that's interesting because my memo pulled up differently than yours.
How about that?
Okay. Yeah, mine even has October 1st on it.
Okay, yeah, there we go.
Well, we'll have to look into what happened.
We're going to post it on the web.
Along with the Crystal Trail, perhaps just an update on the proposed water diversions and Placida Dam issue, because they may not be. We talked to them briefly about it a year ago, but I'm not sure they really realize where
that lies,
where the relocation may be, which is actually would be in Gunnison County, actually outside Pickens County. That's one of the alternatives.
And that's one of the
right has
the Western Divide, right? The Western Divide project issue along the Cristo.
And so that'd be something we prepare.
Yeah. And the other thing I mentioned a while ago, if there's time, it's not a big deal, but the recycling program, you know, that came up a month ago or so, where we have a recycle pickup in Redstone. And everyone from Marble utilizes it, which is great, but we're subsidizing not only Redstone residents, but also Marble residents who live in Gunnison County.
Any further, Rachel?
Well, I would just say that if John Ely feels there are other topics related to water that we should touch on or give a heads up to or anything like that, I mean, Placida is a great example of that, and this may have already fully filled up our time slot, but it seems that, you know, a little bit of a continuing concern on the western slope is this desire by some of the Front Range water diverters to see no more recreational in-channel diversions, or if so, ones that are simply meaningless. And, you know, I check with John Ely to see if there are more specifics, but their basin and our basin are the last two potential sources of new water, and so maintaining tight communications with them on that I think is very important.
Okay. John, anything else on this
item? On that item, no. Unless the board has anything.
No, it looks like we're good. If everyone's okay, let's go to MOIs.
You know, we only have one MOI, Jack, which is the library, and Kathy's not here yet. I do wonder if maybe we should talk about future agendas a little bit, maybe reverse the...
Yeah, let's go ahead and skip over to the future agendas.
One of the things that I wanted to chat with you about is a while back over when we were in the Rio Grande, we had a presentation on the guardrails, potential for guardrails of Castle Creek, and at that time the board had requested a site visit. We got, I think, kind of busy with opportunities to you know, do other work up there, but we're coming back to a point where we could try and schedule a site visit. It would take at least 2 hours to probably go and see those different locations. I guess I might get some feedback. One, if the board wanted to try and fit that in this fall before the snows really start coming, which is probably going to be in the next 4 to 6 weeks, we should probably be thinking about getting up there. And if there is a date right now, that would work better for board members. There may be some dates that we're not aware of that you'd be out of town on an off day. Or we could try and schedule it earlier in the morning on a Tuesday. Or
what do we want to do early on the morning this time of year? It's
good kind of chill out there.
Yeah.
So we definitely want to do it early.
I said,
I got a coat.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I'm up for whatever works for everyone.
Yeah, you know, given the budget season coming up rapidly, you know, I just have to say, I'm not so sure that there's something wrong with seeing it when there's snow on the road. I mean, that's part of the whole question about, is there a need for safety and guardrails? So, I mean, I'm not trying to delay when the site visit is, but I guess for me personally, it's less urgency to feel like we have to do it in the next month.
Well, let me go ahead and we'll propose some dates to you in the future. I think the real question was, are you still interested in doing the site visit this fall? I think the answer is yes. So we'll work next week. We'll propose a few dates that seem to work for staff and what we know of your calendars right now.
And I almost feel a comprehensive, you know, even if it's just a half hour, 15-minute work session before that site visit to look at the detailing of the road, so we know what we're going up there, as opposed to, I mean,
identify those.
How many
areas
times have we all been on that road?
Reissue the memo. You mean because we
reissue the memo? Or, well, I don't know if it's changed. If they're, you know, if the proposed areas have changed, if the scope of the work has changed, that sort of stuff.
And I'm not sure the memo, but the presentation identified on a map those areas that staff had looked at about. What was it, 6,000 feet now,
right,
compared to what it was?
And so we can certainly
have reservations
that
about that.
Background information again.
Sure.
Yeah, I would like to try to do this fall. I think the problem in winter, I mentioned this when we had that presentation, is there's probably going to be some other people who want to attend, and it's going to be challenging enough in terms of pulling up on the road and walking around. And in winter, you know, I think it would be that much more dangerous. So, even if possible, I would do it in the fall. I don't have a sense of urgency if we can't get it done this fall and next spring. But I think winter is a whole safety issue. That,
And I actually believe that when you have something on the table, you do it as soon as it fits.
Yeah.
And that's what I would propose and agree. I was thinking exactly the same thing of us standing around by a curb. Not too worried about it because, you know, hopefully it'd see people, but Rachel.
Yeah, and I was just thinking about how limited my days are right now, but, you know, currently Friday the 28th, and maybe we should at least give you some dates to think about, because that's where I don't want to be. Oops, sorry,
right.
I can't go. But Friday the 28th, but that would put us into basically 5 days, given the regular, the Lenado that week, the housing summit, and everything like that.
28th of September.
September, and that's the only open day I see so far right now. And then October 3rd would be a potential, I guess. That's a Wednesday. Just bear in mind that they always have the 1177s for the fourth, third Monday of each month in Glenwood. So that's all I'm looking at, is just how difficult it gets. But Wednesday, October 3rd, and then perhaps Monday, October 8th, or Friday, October 12th. So, you know, I at least want to kind of give some dates to start shooting at instead of leave it wide open.
Do any of those dates not work for?
I'd like to stay away from Friday if possible, if we have it open Friday. It's a nice fall for long weekend getaways here.
Sure.
Well, in addition, after the housing summit, I'm not sure that we want to do something.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a long
but week. But like all the other previous meeting, I'm around.
Yeah, and Wednesday the 3rd would maybe work for the most of us.
That works for me.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll look at that date.
Yeah, you know, the only problem is that, you know, I'm sure everyone runs into it, but sometimes you're trying to schedule medical stuff, and then, you know, once you get that date locked down, you hate to have to move something else. So the sooner we get our dates set up, the better. For
And that's why I say kind of sooner than later. And I don't mind, even though I go to Denver the Thursday.
Right.
I don't care if I have 3 days of a travel day.
Yeah, that sounds
Let's
good.
Let's do it.
Okay.
So the only other thing, two things I wanted to bring to your attention. One, on the 25th, Jack, as you're pointing out, we're going to extend the time for the broadband update and also for the pro-cycling wrap-up. We double-booked our second the 2012 budget update.
That was kind of that question.
And so we'll fill in that time we'll be able to, I think, use that well. And then just to draw your attention, from 5 to 6 that day, we do have our Citizen Board Appreciation Reception in Veterans Park. So just wanted to be sure you saw that next week. And that's really all I had for your future agendas right now.
Yes. Yeah, small details. You know, make sure we have some sort of backup if we have weather on that employee appreciation party. It may be that the clerk is already in this room. In the past, we've had to pull it in here really quickly, but we might not have it available.
They won't be in here yet. October 1st we've got this room until October 1st.
Just wanted to make sure we had a backup. And then in terms of future agendas, I just need to let you guys know that I have a jury duty summons for Thursday, October 18th, and you cannot find out until, you know, the night before as to whether it's been canceled. So that just puts me as a question mark for the meeting with Garfield County or the EOTC meeting that evening. So just so people are aware of that.
Well, maybe to avoid the EOTC meeting, I'll take your drink. George.
Thursday, September 27th for the Housing Summit. On our future agendas, we have this at 8:30 in the morning, but on today's information, we have it at 9 in the morning.
It changed this morning to 9. When we were working at the summit concept, we had a half hour of kind of introductory comments by elected officials, and since it's really a joint work session, that didn't seem as necessary, so we eliminated that.
On the same day, can I drop in real quick? I may be a tad late on the 27th. I have a presentation set up in front of Rotary on the watershed issues. So I'll get over there as soon as I can that morning.
And so, John, in preparation for that meeting, I mean, there'll be a coffee and a roll or something in case people are running. Good. Any other future agendas, Board? Go ahead, George.
October 9th, we've got an exec session set just for an hour. So I don't know, depending on what's on that, if that's going to be too short a period of time.
Yeah.
I don't know why you think that, George, but our option there, that's starting to get into our budget presentations is what's squeezing us there.
I would say, depending on what's there, maybe people are coming in at 9.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
During lunch, especially during budget periods. I can see us doing memos of interest, future agendas, and open discussion during lunch.
Brown bag it.
Brown bag it.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. We can do that.
And then that will be determined by the items. Meeting, if John says, an hour and a half of work, or whatever.
Okay, so we get closer in.
We have confirmed a new date with Lake County, October 22nd.
That did make it on here. That wasn't supposed to make it on here, Jack. Lake County is now thinking the spring. They're concerned about the potential for encountering weather coming over the pass that late in October. So they're saying they may want to come over in the spring now.
Well, it won't be the spring. It'll be the summer.
Yeah.
It would be the summer.
That's fine.
I thought we were going over there.
I disagree with that. Excuse me, Rachel. Yeah. If they don't want to come here, we have had a habit of going there. They're doing us a great favor, but... And I know we don't have a lot of working operational things mm-hmm. together, but they're a good group of people, and you never know when, the need for allies and communication occurs. As an individual, and then we get others' feedback, I wouldn't still mind going over there then. And maybe even the inn is opening again. I saw something when I was there a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I know they're doing construction. I don't know if they're going to be open this year.
Okay. So anyway, that's just Yeah, we can keep putting it off, but...
I would go over there. I'd put a request that we have lunch at the grill, though.
I don't think they're open for lunch.
They used to be.
I don't know if they are, but...
Do you want us to try and see if we can find a date to drive over there?
I would do that, and under the condition of weather, we would respectfully, whomever was going whichever way, we would just cancel.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that date still work for them? They just didn't want to drive over?
Potentially, yeah.
Well, the 1177s are always at 4th Monday, you know.
Okay.
It just always gets scheduled for repayment hearings or something. I don't know why. Now, the 8th, October 8th, is open as a Monday.
I mean, I'd support whatever date, whatever flexibility.
Or you guys can do it as 4, and I'll go the 1177. I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to be all 5 of us. Either way.
I think, as Jack pointed, I mean, we have some topics to discuss with them, but we don't have necessarily a lot of...
Heavy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so again, you could certainly do it without me, or if it's the 8th, I can do that day.
I suspect they chose the 22nd because of something, in their schedule, but we'll check with them.
Okay.
Any other future agendas? I see we can move on. Do we want to go back to the library quarterly?
Oh, wait, one last thing on future agendas. I think the next QQ meeting is going to be Wednesday, October 31st, Halloween. No. It was either that or the day after the election, and I said, let's do Halloween. But I just want to let you know so we don't schedule something else here. I will definitely be gone on the 31st.
It's not, Jack, may I?
Yeah.
Okay. It's not on our schedule, but do we cancel the meeting due to the election?
On the 30th, we did because there were...
November 6th.
Oh, no, coming up, November 6th.
It's still here as a work session.
We haven't canceled that. Yeah, I mean, typically we do, and that would be our recommendation. It's just not hitting your future agendas.
Yeah. I mean, I agree with the policy.
Okay. Kathy, would you like to join us up front, please? And the usual start, keep in mind. Introduce yourself.
Okay, I'm Kathy Chandler, the county librarian, and I'm just here with a semi-annual update to tell you about things that are going on at the library. And you should have received a report in your packet, and if you have specific questions, I'd be glad to address them, or if you'd like me to briefly review this document, I'd be happy to do that too. Shall I just kind of talk through it?
Yeah, why don't you do a couple, kind of a topical. You have a lot of good topics here, of course.
Okay, well, what we've done in this update is try to link our activities to the strategic plan and the goals that the county's working on. Most of our activities are under the livable and supportive community bubble of the plan. And specifically access to recreation, education, arts, and culture. So we've been working hard to try and help individuals as the playing field for accessing individuals' information keeps moving. And one thing that we've done recently is we bought 11 Nooks, so that and that's an e-reader from Barnes & Noble. And we selected that particular model because it's one that we could lock down, and it's, some of them, the e-readers, if you loan them to a member of the public, it's sort of like giving them a free credit card. They could just buy whatever they want to and load it on the e-reader, whereas these we could lock down, and we have about 250 titles on these e-readers so that people can check them out, take them on vacation, or use them at home and just get a feel for the world of e-readers, as to whether or not they like that format.
Can I ask a quick question on that?
Sure.
Can you just explain what a Nook is? And is this new for Picken County Library? Because I know Basalt Regional Library has the ability to take out
e-books,
e-readers
already. It's not particularly new. I just sort of noticed I had never told you folks about it. We've had them for a little bit over a year. And there's three big e-readers in the field, Kindle from Amazon, Nook is from Barnes & Noble, and then the Sony e-reader. And so as I was saying, the reason we selected Nooks is because you can, you know, just load them up and say that's what's going to be on this e-reader right now until we change the titles, as opposed to just giving somebody an e-reader that would be equivalent to giving them a blank check that they could just go home and start downloading things, and it would be charged to our account because that's what is linked to the e-reader. So anyway, Jocelyn Durance, who's the assistant director of the library, had kind of described our role right now as connecting the works of writers with readers, in whatever format that would be. So we have been working with Marmot, and our library has been taking kind of a lead role in helping to work with publishers to try and get rights to buy e-content for our libraries. Douglas County, which is the county just south of the metropolitan area in Denver, it's has like Castle Rock, they have put together a system that everyone in the library world is referring to as the Douglas County model, which is they put together a computer that is very secured so that we can assure publishers that if they let us buy their e-content, it's not going to be stolen the way you know, things happen with the music industry. And yet the six largest publishers in the country are not selling their e-content to libraries, and rather are forcing libraries to rent that, and so that you're buying that same content year after year, which is not a model that we want to embrace, because we're used to being able to buy a book, and if, you know, we feel there's still going to be demand for it 30 years from now, we would keep that on the shelf, as opposed to renting it and then suddenly having them pull the plug and say, well, that's not available anymore. So we've got a Marmot meeting later on this week, and we'll find out more about how things are going there. But meanwhile, we've bought quite a few titles from some independent publishers who are willing to play ball with the library world. And we've also been working with the local authors to help them load their novels or works of nonfiction into an e-reader format. And we've been purchasing the titles from local authors to make those available. We're also getting ready to reinvent our web page and try and bring the maintenance of that in-house so that it's easier for us to update the web page content. And I noted in here that we realized how very important it is to have the web page designed to make it easy for people to use. Because we added a search bar to the top of our web page to get people into the magazine databases, and the use for that went in 1 month from about 200 to 1,600 hits, and I'm sure that will continue to grow as people become used to being able to get into this copyrighted, peer-reviewed magazine databases. So we signed up about 3,300 new library card holders in the past year and checked out about 204,000 items last year. That represents an increase in our circulation from 2008 to 2011. Our circulation went up 16%, and for the first half of this year, we were up nearly another 8% over where we were the first half of last year. So the use continues to grow, and a lot of that has to do with the increased programming that we've had at the library that brings more people in. During the summer reading program this past year, the children's services librarians decided that it would be a good idea to start a new group of kids called tweens, that are those kids between the lower elementary and the high school age, to break them out into their own group. And so that was a good move. And our summer reading program, the number of kids registered for that was 469 during this past summer.
Wow, that's great.
And then they've also the young adult programming for the total for last year of programs held were 708 programs, and already this year they've had 704. So they've had things like a teen advisory board who've been helping us plan activities, and also looking at the proposed design for the proposed library renovation and addition. But they also do things like make appointments for little kids to join them down in the children's room and work with them on their reading skills after years, and after school, and that's a program called Pitkin Pals. And we've also had a program called Pause to Read, where they bring in a trained dog, service animal, that little kids can sit there and read to a dog, which a lot of libraries have found has been very successful for kids who have trouble with reading or with speech.
Or with the grown-ups.
Yeah, well, anyway, you know, it's like, you know, they just really seem to have taken off in this program with being able to just sit there and read to a dog and not feel like they're being criticized as they stumble over words, which is what I'm doing today, too.
There's some grants in here for you.
What's that?
Yeah, there's some grants in here for you to read to.
Anyway, let's see. We also, I put in here a segment on improved community engagement and participation, that we have been doing lots of meetings with the city primarily as far as the design of the proposed library addition. And over the course of the spring and summer, we went through their planning and zoning, the housing board, and lastly the city council, and had a lot of discussions about the design of the roof line for the proposed addition. And in response to the comments of those various commissions and councils, we revised our plan and brought the roof line down over what under what had initially been proposed. And we added skylights in many areas of the roof to help break up the shadowing on the plaza. And did a lot of lighting studies, you know, that kind of showed that during the winter the sun is positioned in such a way that because of the angle that the town is built on, this the proposed renovation wouldn't actually add any shading to the plaza. But anyway, we felt like when all was said and done, we had a better plan than we had started out with. And I put some pictures in here that show the height of the proposed library renovation compared to some of the neighboring buildings. Our proposal starts out at a height of 17 feet and then peaks at one point. It gets up to 28 feet, which is the new height limitation for downtown Aspen. And then the roof drops back down to 23 feet. So we tried to design a building that would respect the neighbors, and we stepped the building back on the north side so that the view of Red Mountain, you can see over the top of the outdoor reading deck, and it doesn't cut that view off as much as it would be if it were just a solid wall building. And we started out with the public meeting room being about a story and a half, and then moved to a two-story addition. And then step back down again, as I said, to this outdoor reading deck. So we also had the pollster come in the summer and report to you about the results of the opinion poll, where they called lots of the people in the library district to go through a series of questions of statements that were in opposition to the library proposal and statements in support. And based on the result of that poll, then of course you put our questions on the ballot for us, and we'll see what happens on election day. We've also, in addition to these public meetings, Martha Durgy has been in charge of our public relations, and it used to be in the old days when the newspapers were not having to compete so much with the internet that we could rely strictly on press releases, but as the years have gone by, we've had to change our way of doing business in trying to reach the public and have entered into agreements with papers for weekly ads, and also we are writing a weekly blog and an e-newsletter once a month, and to encourage attendance at a lot of the adult programming that Martha and Susan Cottle have been putting on for the public, that include things like an adult book club that meets once a month. There's also a reading for adults that's that happens on every third Sunday of the month. They just had a really successful one reading the works of some of the local writers like Bruce Berger, Freddie the Fisher, and some of the local actors have been helping us with that. It's a program that's been sponsored by Friends of the Library, and they're just about to start a crafts club. Saul Lowitz and Phyllis Lowitz are summer residents who come every summer for the music festival, and Phyllis does an annual lecture on the opera that the MAA is being performs each summer, and really packed demand for her presentation this year on the magic flute. And then Saul, who's a retired physician from Florida, teaches an Excel computer class for students during the summer too, just for free. So all in all, the meeting room is very popular. We had 580 bookings in the meeting room last year, and the total of attendance at library programs was about 7,700 people. We continue to work on the early literacy skills for the little kids, and I think I mentioned last year we started a baby story hour. That was a new program, and there were almost 1,000 attendees at that program last summer. And then the library is often used for English in Action tutors who work with their partners who are people for whom English is a second language. And there's 85 of those teams here in Aspen, and a lot of them meet weekly at the library to work together, and so that was one reason that we were working on the proposed edition, was to try to bring the fiction collection up on the mezzanine, which is no longer ADA compliant, down to the main level, and turn some of that mezzanine area into small study rooms so that those people would have a place where they could be a little bit more vocal. We're getting ready to replace all of our public computers from Marmot. Marmot is a library consortium that we were instrumental in helping start back in 1985. And our computer, our catalog and circulation system has been computerized since about 1987. And we have been working for several years re-indexing our collection and changing all of the call numbers so that they all have unique call numbers, which gives us then the capability to use an RFID tag reader that's a mobile unit that you can take out to the shelves and use that to do inventory, and also do shelf reading to make sure that the books are in order on the shelf. We were also concerned still about the security for the children's room, and hoping that if we get the new children's library up on the main level of the building, that that will be then a destination point in the library that people won't be using as a hallway anymore, and it'll make it a little bit easier for the children's librarians to serve the children as opposed to running a very busy circulation desk downstairs where they're checking out all of the non-print media from the children's or from the music library. Then I guess I put a little update in here about the building. We were able to change out the coping on the around the roof of the library that's been deteriorating for several years because it was made of concrete. We cut back and didn't put stone in when we first built the building to save money, and the concrete's been deteriorating. So Jody Smith from the building department got that project done this year and replaced that coping with stone. And we're also well aware of the fact that we really need to get the flat portion of the roof replaced because the membrane is 21 years old and it's been pulling away from the edges as it sort of shrinks with age. But we've been patching the roof in hopes that if we are able to do the addition We would then fix that roof later on because we anticipate there'd be quite a bit of traffic on the roof if we were doing a major building project. So we've also delayed working on the energy audit because we don't want to rebalance our systems and then change the way the building's configured. But we're hoping that we'll be able to use a lot of green practices in and such things as harvesting daylight. I think that that would probably help our building a lot if you put those pipes in with the lenses where, you know, you capture the sunlight and it looks like the lights are on, but it's just actually the sun coming into the building. So anyway, those are kinds of things that we've been thinking about working on. And do you have any questions in particular?
I have a question. I really don't understand why the library needs to have an expansion. You've got new library card holders of 3,382. We've got circulation up 7.7% over the last 6 months. Last year, we had 580 users of the library room, meeting room. We've got new programs from preschool to tweens to teens to adults. You've got an English in Action program. We got a whole new e-reader program, so people can access books via e-reader versus having to purchase them. I don't understand why we need a new library. There doesn't seem like there's any use of this library, some people seem to think.
Well, there's some others that also agree with you.
Well, yes.
One facetious
talk. Yeah, tongue in cheek. I think it just shows the incredible increase in the use of the library as a community asset, much greater than actually our population growth.
Uh-huh.
It just shows more and more people are using the library for a variety of reasons versus just taking out books like in the old days.
Uh-huh. Well, yes, it's, you know, just really a changed playing field. And I guess we're trying to preserve some of the old and move somewhat into the new, you know, because I don't think books are just going to dry up and blow away after hundreds of years of use. We really would like to make our collection more fun to use. I think I maybe mentioned before, again from Douglas County, they've done studies on the way people check out books, and they say 60% of the books that they check out from their library are things that people discovered once they entered the building. And so that's one of the reasons that we're looking for more room, is to spread our collection out and make it more browsable and more user-friendly, more things on display, more face-out shelving, and just help people discover what the community already owns. You know, Michael Owsley has spoken quite eloquently of the Commonwealth, you know, that like the community commons where people share their wealth and build something like a library. And I know that you guys have received some letters, you know, saying that nobody's using the library, and so I appreciate your pointing out those statistics. And I did call one of the people and left a message saying that, you know, some of the statistics that they're using, I think they must have gotten into some old data, because they're saying things like that our library is three times larger than Steamboat's, where Steamboat's is actually larger than ours. The Grand Junction Library has moved out of its facility, their main branch, right now because they're adding a 10,000 square foot expansion there, but they also have another 8 branch libraries that serve their area. So some of the statistics, you're kind of comparing apples and oranges. And the Aspen Library, in the state of Colorado, there's a separate category called resort libraries. And our library right now with its square footage is at about the 75th percentile of all of the resort libraries. And were we to be able to realize this addition, it would move us from 2.27 square feet per capita to 2.79 square feet per capita. And what is considered a library in the 95th percentile is 3.33 square feet. So we're still well below, like a library like Telluride, which is actually smaller than our library, but they have a smaller population, they're at 3.41 square feet per capita. So we're definitely looking at something that is in the range of a reasonable size library for a resort community, because we do serve second homeowners and we do serve the tourists. And I think, you know, some of the people we've been going out and talking to, some of the real estate agents, for instance, you can tell that they see that when you invest in your community, it adds value to the property. So I'm hoping that, you know, we can get that message out, but we'll just see what happens.
Any further questions, comments?
I just wanted to ask, what year was the library completed and first opened?
In 1991. Yeah, so it's 21 years old, and
okay, that's all.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Kathy. Appreciate all the feedback.
Sure.
Great job.
See you later. Thank you.
Okay, board. Guess we're at open discussion. John?
Yeah. Yeah, I've got a few items for you today. You may recall a while back, Georgia Hansen had contacted us about supporting them hosting a conference of museum, I believe it's museum directors, Mountain Plains Museum Association, here, and they're putting their proposal together. There are a few other communities that are also competing for that same conference. And she was looking for a letter of support from Pickin County, not committing us to do anything or provide resources, but that we're supportive of hosting that conference in our community. You previously offered our support for her pursuing this, and so I wanted to put that request in front of you and see if you'd like us to draft a letter for the chair's signature.
Yeah, I remember it was an email correspondence that Georgia had sent, and it was just real tentative. Mm-hmm. I can't remember if it was July, because I think it was May, because I remember I was traveling, and I just sent back that I think it'd be great. We talk about economic development all the time, how we can help it in small ways, and that while we don't have financial resources per se to commit to helping host any of the receptions or anything, it would seem appropriate we could do something with our open space staff to highlight the Emma store or how we've dealt with some of the other historic properties on county open space, and that they're just different nexuses that could fit within the program. So, you know, again, without committing that we're underwriting this event in any way, although I would consider looking at that, it's just me, in small ways. I do think that it's just great to be able to bring all these people into town from out of town and see what we've been able to do with historic preservation and mm-hmm. telling our story. So okay. I'd be supportive of a letter.
And you said possibly supporting, you know, putting on the event with a small contribution.
I can see doing something like that. I mean, I just try to think, and I wouldn't know the exact details, but there was a time when I think when Patty was able to bring in the larger NARC board that she was serving on, and they all stayed out at the Meadows, and you know, it's a little bit of off-season economic activity. So, yeah, I can see something like that, but we don't have a request in front of us, and, you know, I was thinking very minor. I just support a letter at this time and then see if there's anything else. But I do think we could, and it's not unusual when there's organizations that visit for staff to be able to demonstrate some of the projects, you know, whether it's people touring to come see our affordable housing projects or touring our airport, or, again, I think we could demonstrate at least some of what we've done with our ComDev historic preservation guidelines and how we've tried to assist with that sort of rural historic preservation, as well as the nexus we have with some of our open space purchases.
And how big is this supposed to be, John? You might have even mentioned,
It's about 350 to 400 people over 6 days. Georgia did indicate that, you know, they may be approaching us at a later time to see if we could participate, you know, in an event or events, but they haven't gotten to that point in planning. So probably along the lines of what Rachel's talking about, I'm guessing. But right now, really, all they're looking for is they just want to be able to provide some assurance that, you know, our community's welcome and open to hosting this type of event, which, you know, obviously we're pretty well built for at this point.
Yeah, I would be supportive of the letter, and maybe, you know, oftentimes we've been asked, well, do you want to be a
co-sponsor or...
Yeah, I was trying to think of the not sponsor, but the co-sponsorship, and according to what our, you know, balances in our fund, I would offer a few bucks. I don't know what that means, 300, I mean, honestly, because I don't know balances. But I'd be inclined to do that because, though they're not asking, and we, you know, state that for the record, as it were, I think this is a great boost in the arm of the community. Not only for business sake, but just having people hear a different group at that time of the year.
If I could jump on, I agree with that, Jack. And, you know, a lot of times at events I go to, it will be someone helped underwrite the coffee and Danish in the morning at one event, or maybe they helped underwrite the appetizers at the end of the day reception. And so I can see, again, a very small role as we've talked about how do we encourage some economic development. But at this point, the request, I think, is really more about our support in general, and, you know, if they put a program together, would we have some staff expertise that could help fill out that agenda without having to always bring in, you know, speakers from afar as well?
No, I would support that, but also in this informal discussion, I would ask, I think, like you're saying, that might be a nice gesture, as well as, you know, Aspen and Pitkin County. Some of the sponsors. Bob?
I'm totally in support of the letter.
Yeah, George?
Yeah.
Well, and the other idea, at least to explore.
Well, that's what you say.
Let's wait for the ask, and let's, and our discretionary fund, I think.
Yeah, well, that's
totally appropriate to put some money towards
that.
No,
I don't know what the balance is, and it's not important now, of course.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Anything else over in discussion?
And Jack, you may want to jump in on this one, but Jack and I had an opportunity to visit with Reeves Brown and Greg Winkler from Department of Local Affairs. Oh, sorry, Jack, steal your thunder there. We had a great discussion. We actually got them all to ourselves. Snowmass Village had to cancel, and I guess Steve was out of town that day. It was what happened, so that I think worked out really well. We had an opportunity to talk about the our strategic plan, and particularly our six focus areas, and Reeves has already put me in contact with a number of other cabinet members who, you know, may have programs and such that link in, and I thought it was a really good, we used up the full time, just the two of us. So.
Yeah, it was really nice and informal, and, you know, have a cup of coffee and, you know, chat. Obviously multiple topics, and one of our strategic goals, of course, is communications, the broadband thing, whatever, and John led into that. And I happened to ask, because we were talking about grants, you know, actually, how could we link up, because we seldom really work with DOLA, meaning we don't get a large amount, and we identified some small, you know, $20,000+ we get through different pieces of DOLA, and I asked about, well, how about technology, and Greg, our local representative, indicated that, well, there's some administrative grants that might really play right with what we're doing with our investigations now and, you know, bringing this forward, so I and I'm sure John is thinking we might certainly follow up for an administrative grant. Is really a nice source of just a few bucks to you know, enhance the process. So that's right on.
Thanks for attending that on our behalf, Jack. It's great.
Yeah, well, it was good. Reeves is such an outstanding individual. And I will admit that I complimented him on the evolution of Club 20 in the sense of how it had gone from previous director to when he took over, and it became more diverse in opinions expressed and minority opinions. Those things were even allowed. So, you know, it was excellent.
And I thank certainly John for all of his background stuff that he was providing also.
Just real quick, Tom Isaac is going to be in next week to talk about the website issues. We had that discussion during our last open discussion. I think we're all a little surprised, and he has prepared though a memo, so we'll bring him in under MLIs or such to talk about what they're doing with their website and such. I know it's been in both papers already, and he was possibly going to try and make it over for open discussion, but it looks like he wasn't able to attend today. So we will bring that discussion back. And then October 4th and 5th, just so you know, I was looking at doing a half day on both of those days, a seminar over at the Aspen Institute. So I'm hoping to take the afternoons there. I'll be in the morning. And that is about it.
Okay. Any other open discussion? Board members?
Rachel. A small one. I received some letters that were the BLM comments that Club 20 was sending out on Bureau of Land Management, new proposed, more stringent oil and gas regulations. Of course, Club 20 was opposing those. So I'm not even sure when that deadline is, but I just got them a couple days ago. So I'd like to forward them to John Peacock to take a look at, and then have him check with Ellen about, is there a new comment period on what the BLM is doing or not. You know, I'm just not sure where this is flowing from, but I'll forward them to you, okay. And you can investigate with Ellen, and if it's appropriate for us to make a comment, because if the BLM is starting to implement more environmentally sound protection measures, I'd like to give them support in that.
And I would think we could run it by John Ely, too. Is there, you know, some real
meat to it, or is it?
Yeah, benefits to us, really, in the operations of the rules,
sure,
and regs, or is it,
yeah,
sugarcoating?
Yeah, and again, I really don't know. I think it may have to do with this larger issue of starting to disclose fracking fluids. And, you know, that's always been a little bit of a dispute in Colorado of the state makes its own rules, but the federal government will maintain that state rules don't apply to federal land. And so, you know, we've always wanted to see them mirroring the more stringent rules that were put in place before. That's all. So I'll forward that
anything
when I get
home.
Anything else, George?
Yeah, I just wanted to let the board know, and John can give us a quick update, that, as you know, I've been continually trying to resolve the issue with the conveyance of our agreement with the landowner for the land approvals we did on the Red Mountain Ranch
for
the conveyance of Gold Butte to the open space. And I got hold of the owner a few weeks ago, had a good conversation, and he said he didn't see any reason why this had been held up, and he contacted the attorney. And what I understand is everything's been signed, and all the documents are over in ComDev. And so the next step has to be that we'll need an ordinance that will come before Open Space and the BLCC for approval so that conveyance and those documents can actually be recorded.
Excuse me, George, that is correct. We now have all the proper paperwork in hand. The one step that we have to take now is we did have an ordinance in front of you a while back, but we recommended denying the ordinance. You may recall this because we had some concerns about the language that was in the deed at that point. And so that has all been worked through. So now what is left is we need to Open Space and Trails, when their staff comes back, they're at a conference this week, they'll be preparing an ordinance for your next two regular meetings for you to accept that, and we should finally have that one put to bed.
Good work, George.
Thank you for following up on that, George.
Yeah, good, maybe the climbers can eventually legally climb up there.
Exactly. That's great. The owner was very nice and great to talk to, and he said, I'll call my attorney immediately and see what's hanging it up, and we got it done.
Very nice.
Okay. I have a couple. John, on the practical side, up Maroon Creek Road at Highlands, where the little roundabout is, just before you get there, I have to admit that I wasn't aware of this a couple of years ago, but Ruth, when she was the ticket manager, mentioned just Sunday, hey, that problem has been here for a while, but now it's terrible. And what I'm talking about is the concrete pad
around it.
That is fractured and actually very dangerous. I hope we take care of that.
It's not scheduled for this year. We do have it in our capital plan, I believe, for next year to repair the concrete. And I was just up there this weekend also, and it's certainly, the surface is not good. It needs to be repaired.
Well, it's dangerous in that there is actually fractured concrete kind of pushing up and irregular, etc. And I really don't know about bicyclists or any of that. So I think someone, I'd like to suggest that staff looks at that specifically for the safety component, even if it's a temporary. But, you know, I don't know what we're looking at, the whole roundabout. I'm not saying that. But literally, there's probably 4 feet by 4 feet or so. At the roundabout just before Highlands, on the coming downhill side right there.
So the Highway 82 roundabout, or more the speed bumps up at the base of Highlands? See, I don't really think of it as a roundabout. Maybe that's why I'm getting
The speed humps.
Actually, you're correct. Thank you for qualifying.
The little islands.
It is traffic common divide. That's really what it is.
Because
it's not a roundabout. It's not traveled around. So, duh.
Across from Chamonix. I knew what you were talking about, the concrete pad.
I think it's dangerous. Yeah, a bicycle gets in there and there's a lot of potential for harm.
You know, at the very least, perhaps we can get one of those road damage ahead signs, you know, so that people are aware. I don't know. But I thank you for bringing it
Let's
up.
Let's just hand the ball off to John and do what we can, you know, and it's our public road, so I don't want to have it.
Yeah, I can see a snowplow picking one of those up.
Since the city didn't annex it with Highlands, but anyway, that's just a personal. Rob, next time we have board reports and you give a COG report, would you please give us an update as to where the governor's bottom-up economic sustainability thing is, just to kind of brief us, because I have to admit I've lost sight.
I think I had it the last time I was in here, but there is another meeting coming up on that.
Regional plans that are the plans.
It was kind of just a follow-up directional meeting.
I want to say on the 26th, maybe, in Frisco again. I just forwarded it to Cindy last week.
Hmm. I'll see if I can find
That'd be good to hear from that. Thanks, Joe.
Yeah, and last thing, I want to thank the board for the flexibility and how I was able to manage the agenda today, because though we ran over a few times, we got some important directions done, and it's good, and here we are. Maybe we're going to be out of here late unless somebody can figure out why not.
Oh, let's be out of here early.
Way early. So that's it for me. And I see nothing else, so I think we're adjourned.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Grassroots.